second time in this decade, college basketball's quest is to qualify for the battle in Seattle. In 84, the powerful front line of the Georgetown Hoyas, led by Patrick Ewing, were too strong for the rest of the tournament field. But unlike other championships, this tournament has a way of crowning Cinderella. Last year, it was Danny Manning in Kansas. In 86, Louisville emerged from a wide open field with a freshman they said never got nervous, and the tears were left for top-seeded Duke. In 85, it was the perfect game pitched by an outmanned Villanova team, a feat some say can never be matched. At Albuquerque in 83, it was the air ball turned assist as NC State left Houston searching for answers to a title taken away. There have been heroic acts at this March party, like the one in New Orleans at the Superdome as Michael Jordan won it for North Carolina in 82. And deja vu in 87 as a smart junior college transfer helped Indiana to the title. And what leader can lay claim as master of this decade? Is it Indiana's Bob Knight or Louisville's Denny Crum? Or could it be Big John at Georgetown? They, like us, are ready for more madness. The march is on.
Again, everyone, and welcome to March Madness on ESPN. I'm Tim Brando, and the 64-team field is ready to shape up. And we'll be focusing on a number of cities today as our NCAA tournament field gets underway, beginning in Greensboro, North Carolina, where it's Minnesota taking on Kansas State. These two teams met once before, Minnesota a winner at home. Now then, we'll take you off to Indianapolis, Indiana, where Loyola Marymount, a team that has scored over 100 points 21 times, takes on Arkansas. From there, we go to the land of the potato, Boise, Idaho, where it's Clemson taking on St. Mary's out of Moraga, California, Northern California town. They're very happy to be there. Then it's back to Greensboro, Tennessee, and West Virginia. Tennessee's making its first trip since 1983. The Mountaineers have had a great year. Then it's on to Music City, USA, for Providence and Virginia. The Cavaliers making their seventh trip in the 80s. Providence at 18-10. Then back to Indianapolis for Ball State, David Letterman School. Let's get on with it, shall we? Ball State taking on Pitt at 10 p.m. Eastern Time. All of that and a great deal more. Here is our NCAA tournament today gets underway. Dick Vitale is by my side. You'll hear his docile tones when we return. West in Boise, Idaho, a little bit later today. Top-seeded Arizona will be taking on a fine ball club in Robert Morris, a team that hasn't been there since 1983. Lute Olson has to guard against overconfidence and the nothing-to-lose syndrome.
Being their number one, I've gotten the feeling people have been aiming at us all year long anyway, so I don't see that as any different. And this group would be disappointed if they were not being aimed at. I really believe that. I think they want to take everyone's best shot.
I want to go into my last college game knowing it's my last college game, which means I want to make it all the way to the final. So I don't want to be in a situation where I walk off the court and say, that was my last college game. I can't believe it. So this is a big time of the year for us.
So there you see the Western Regional in Boise, Idaho, Arizona against Robert Morris, St. Mary's and Clemson, that's an outstanding matchup, Memphis State and DePaul, and Idaho taking on UNLV. Now that Arizona-Robert Morris game, Dick, gets underway in about an hour or so, and we'll be following that game along with every other game that's going on in the NCAA tournament. Robert Morris is not bad. They beat West Virginia earlier in the year.
Well, they beat West Virginia, which really making it surprising. They beat Gail Catlett's team at West Virginia, mm-hmm. and that certainly was a shock. They don't have enough ammunition to play with Sean Elliott and company. If there's one guy that can carry a team to the promised land and cutting down the nets like Danny Manning did last year, it is Elliott. He will be a star in the NBA, and I believe it'll be either Elliott or Ferry, number one or number two in the NBA draft.
All right.
Take it to the bank.
All right. I've taken all that information to the bank, and I still don't have anything in savings. Stay with us. We'll be right back. As we take you to break, we're going to show you the rest of our day, television-wise, on ESPN. We're happy to report that Norm Stewart returned home to Missouri today after spending some time as an outpatient at the University of Texas Cancer Center. He is resting comfortably now and is not an inpatient. He is now taking a look, I'm sure, at Rich Daly and the job that he is going to do as Missouri advances into the NCAA tournament. And disturbing news for Marquette. Apparently, a number of basketball players at Marquette were very surprised that the university had reportedly met officials of the Board of Trustees meeting and voting to fire Bob Duquette, their basketball coach. And I turn to Dick Vitale now about this, because already, Dick, we have 20, count them, 20 coaching changes for next year already at hand.
Tim, it's already been done at Marquette, despite all the so-called denials at this moment. Bobby Duquette has been fired. There's no doubt about it, and I don't like it. There's a sickness going on out there in college coaching today where guys are being fired unbelievably. We got Bob Donawal getting fired at Illinois State. How can anyone explain that? I mean, this man has great credibility, and the beat goes on and on. Mm-hmm. Yet we'll hear presidents scream about bringing sanity to the term student-athlete during the summer. We'll have all these conferences and all these statements, and then we see one coach after another getting the ziggy. And I think it's ridiculous and absurd, because the bottom line, again, it's proving. BB, big-time business. Unless a guy wins and maybe takes the team to the Big 64 and to the big party, he gets the axe. Yeah. And I just think it's absurd and ridiculous. These guys are out there busting their gut. And then they wonder why, in certain situations, guys bend the rules a little bit to go to the next step. I certainly don't condone that, but I hate to see innocent guys losing their jobs because the W's don't exceed the L's, and because we don't have presidents who can call a guy in and say, you know what, you're doing a great job, kids are graduating, I'll give you a five-year extension. We don't hear that.
Yeah, you're right. There's no doubt about that. And, of course, the problems will continue, and the shoe contracts will be there, and the money will escalate.
And they should take all
that
money.
Right. Because of the risk factor, no doubt about it. When we come back, we'll have more here on the NCAA Today. Right now, Minnesota is leading in a big way in Greensboro over K-State. We'll be going out to the Southeast Regional a bit later, and LaSalle and Louisiana Tech for some cut-ins. What a great matchup that one is.
Great matchup. You know, every time I go down to spring training, I'll see Sparky Anderson this year. Sparky screams, Vitale, forget about Elliott, forget about Ferry. The best player in the United States is Lionel Train Simmons. And you know what? He might be right, but watch Randy White. Randy White of Louisiana Tech, big, strong power player, I believe will be the Rip Van Winkle of the NBA draft and will be possibly a top 10 selection. You know what school he's from? There's a guy out of Utah, the best power forward in the game. Not McHale, it's Karl Malone.
He is. Now, let's talk also about Louisiana Tech with respect to their coach. Tommy Joe Eagles has won 5 out of 6 consecutive conference tournament championships.
Yeah, he's done a great job down there, but he'll have a tough time with LaSalle. Speedy Morris, the only guy that's coached a women's team and a men's team.
That's right.
And I like Speedy. He's a fighter.
All right. We're going to get you back out to Greensboro now. Here's the neck sprain, and they took him out of the game, but he has since returned. And right now, Siena may be off to the upset of upsets in this day thus far. Let's get out to Greensboro.
We'd like to welcome those of you joining us from around the country. An upset brewing in Greensboro with the Siena Saints getting outstanding play from 5'11 sophomore point guard Mark Brown. He has scored 16. He's the man with the ball right here. And Stanford trailing in this game, 35-34. Brown going to work on the baseline. Kicks it out to Tom Herter. That's the game clock you see. Time left in the first half. The shot clock at 7. It's up to Brown. Beautiful pass inside, and the stuff by Steve Downing.
Mark Brown today is a surgeon. He is absolutely dissecting a very strong Stanford defense. It's an amazing show.
Taylor for 3. Got it. Terry Taylor has hit 3 three-pointers, and this game is tied. 37 aside, and Siena will play for the final shot.
Looking over to Mike Dean for final instructions, but you know what? He's going to do what he wants to do. He's done it all half, and it's been a plus.
Brown's got Lichty on it. Takes the 3. Missed it. Rebound tipped by Robinson. No, and that's the half, but I believe we've got a foul. We may have a foul on Robinson. Mike Dean coming out to mid-floor. There has been a foul called here on the rebound action by Robinson. So Stanford will have a chance to take the lead into the locker room here as Adam Keefe will go to the foul line. Mark Brown held it right to the last second, but there was time for one shot at the offensive board, and it was a good one. Jeffrey Robinson coming hard from the weak side, but he's caught. Terry Tackett, the official, made the call.
The foul was on Key.
Oh, completely fooled me.
And Robinson misses the 1-1.
All alone at the line like they were the last eight games with no fans.
So we're at the half in Greensboro, Siena 37.
There it is, Mike Dean right now, for the first time not having to whisper to his team in the huddle, tied with Stanford at 37. You could make a case that Siena would have stage fright playing before a crowd. They do have a new nickname, but will the Saints go marching in March? We will soon find out. Our score right now between Loyola Marymount and Arkansas is 49-41 Hogs. Showed you some of Siena. Stanford will keep you posted on the second half of that in a few moments, but right now, under 3 minutes to play in our game, Loyola Marymount on Arkansas, Mick Huber and Jim Gibbons.
Free throw line. 3:03, we're ending our first half here at Indianapolis. Well, Arkansas is leading Loyola Marymount 53-46. Getting a good look at Lee Mayberry. Southwest Conference Newcomer of the Year for Arkansas with 6 points in the first half.
The young man with an unbelievable assist to turnover ratio. It's almost 3-1. 122 assists and 46 turnovers along with 46 steals.
The Lions have trailed by as many as 18 in this first half, and now they're back within seven. Bo Kimble's wide open, wanting for the ball. And he gets it. Make that Terrell Lowry. Wilson got a hand on it, his second block. Wilson, great kick out for Lee Mayberry, who filled the right lane. Ran the break nicely, Jim.
Very well. Filled the lanes very well. Good defense on the perimeter right there when Lowry went to take the jumper.
That's Hank Gathers. There's another bad pass, and Powers will break out and lay it in. So just as Paul Westhead's team was closing the gap, Arkansas's defense has turned the tide.
They've done it with their defense. The last two possessions, Loyola Marymount hasn't gotten a shot at the basket. Two turnovers, two change of possessions, and they converted on both of them.
An air ball by Kemple and a whistle. Foul is going to go against Pear Steamer. That'll be his third. And even 2 minutes remaining in our first half. And coming in for Arkansas is Cannon Whitby. He's an excellent long-range shooter. Going out is Lee Mayberry. And on the free shot line for Arkansas is Lindsey Howell, 6'4", 200-pound junior out of Dallas, Texas. Credit coming back. 24-point half for Credit. Oliver Miller taking a rest. Jim Howell has been angry since he wasn't named one of the top player, the top player in the Southwest Conference.
You bet he was. In the games I saw him, and the game that I did see him playing in this one, a very, very well, he's the leading scorer and leading rebounder. And that's what incensed everybody. And then, of course, he was the most valuable player in the Southwest Conference tournament.
Arkansas by 13. Gathers with a miss. Kicked back out. Steamer saving it.
Give Gallers credit, boy. He kept that ball alive.
Howell hustling on defense, knocked it away, so the Lions will keep it.
You see Gallers last time. He couldn't get the third attempt, but he had the presence of mind to swat the ball out there and get the offense going again.
140 remaining in the first half. 59-46 Arkansas.
Fryer has really been quiet the first 20 minutes. They've shut him down pretty well.
And a whistle and a foul is called down low against Arkansas. Paul Westhead, 50 years old, in his fourth year at Loyola Marymount. 79-61 overall. There's Tom Peabody coming back.
Well, I knew Paul when he was coaching at LaSalle. He was there for 9.
2-point lead now, and Whitby's trying for two in a row. Gathers a rebound. Here's Peabody. Fryer. Kemble. Whitby's made a presence since he came into the game. Gathers. Here's a last second shot by Arlen Bowers. Hits the glass, but won't fall. And so
we can finally catch our breath here at the Hoosier Dome in Indianapolis. A halftime score, the Arkansas Razorbacks 68, the Loyola Marymount Lions 53, and we'll be back.
Get a calculator for half number two. Loyola Marymount with that Keystone Cop approach to college basketball, surrendering a lot of points in this game to Arkansas. In a couple of games of the NCAAs, they accrued 330 points or better for the opposition, and it appears that Arkansas is headed for that many right now. Dick Vitale has joined me, yours truly, Tim Brando, for NCAA Today. So far, not really a lot of surprises, although I think some might think Louisiana Tech, the score, the margin of victory, was something not many people expected.
Well, you know, I wasn't really shocked in terms of that performance because Randy White's a great player, and they played people tough during the year. I mean, they played LSU, as we talked about, beat them at LSU. They took Syracuse to overtime, and certainly they got a good basketball team. Lionel Simmons is still a great player, and I hope he returns to school. There's some wild rumors that maybe he'd go to the NBA draft. I don't believe he will. I believe Lionel Simmons will be back at LaSalle and get close to the 3,400 mark in point totals.
And it appears that that theory, Dick, about Big Ten teams having problems in the past in NCAAs because they don't call it as loosely in the NCAA as they do in the Big Ten doesn't wash right now because Minnesota has advanced.
Well, Minnesota really played well. They did a great job defending the three-point shot. Kansas State's a tremendous three-point shooting team with Henson especially, an outstanding shooter. But defensively, their perimeter defense was excellent. As I said earlier, I think there's certain elements you need to win. You need guard play. You need three-point perimeter defense. You need the ability to shoot the three-point shot. And you also have to have the ability of a coach on the sideline who's had a little experience, I believe, if you're going to win it all. What I'm trying to say, the formula adds up to a team from out in the Washington area. No, not Maryland. That team is called Georgetown, the Hoyas.
All right, now let's talk about that Minnesota and Kansas State game because the Golden Gophers were golden early on against Kansas State today. Lon Kruger ready to take his team to a third consecutive appearance, and Clem Haskins leading the Gophers. Gophers dug a hole for K-State early. Gaffney canning a three-pointer, Minnesota by seven. But the offense was the key for Minnesota. Watch Willie Burton after the miss, aggressively going to the hole, 18 first-half points. Burton did it from the outside with time running out at the end of the first half. And the Gophers up by 10. In the second half, when Burton missed, little Kevin Lynch, where did he come from? Skying and putting it in, Lynch had 10 second-half points. Same anxious moments for the Gophers in the second half as Lakeith Humphrey takes it in for the hoop. And the outside shooting of Minnesota was the key, though. Melvin Newborn from downtown. K-State's big gun, of course, is Steve Hansen. He just couldn't find it today. The iron was truly unkind for Steve and the rest of the Wildcats today. 86-75 as Lon Kruger's team looks on at that defeat. 86-75, Minnesota moving on in the Eastern Regional. Now, let's show you the bracketing now because Minnesota looks to be in great shape. Whether they get Stanford, who's not playing as well as some people expected, against Siena today, or against Siena, which could, very frankly, pull off the upset of the day. West Virginia, Tennessee, Duke, and South Carolina State in that particular region. Speaking of Siena and Stanford, let's show you what developed in half number one of that game. Siena, with no butterflies early, Steve McCoy across to Monty Henderson. Nice lay-in, counted in the foul. Saints with a two-point lead. Now, Todd Lifty was helped off a minor neck sprain, returned a few minutes later in the first. Then Siena made a big run. Mark Brown weaves and negotiates through the lane, and the Saints go up by eight at that point. But it is now tied 37-37, and largely because Lichty was able to get back into the basketball game. Now, I look at this game, Dick, and I say, you know, Siena's a better team than most of the country realizes. I mean, they handled Pitt. I mean, this is a team that's got some talent. But as you look at the brackets across the country, the Passe fan says, what, Siena?
Siena, they can't believe it. But remember this. Siena also went down to Florida and took them to the buzzer when Florida really had all its people. And Florida has that great front court. Siena can play. They got a major league back court. Mark Brown can stroke it. He's from the state of Michigan. Michael Dean, their coach, was an assistant to Judd Heathcote. Dean could become a big name where people can get excited about Dean. And maybe he says bye-bye to Siena and gets that megabuck contract a la Tom Penders. Somebody will blossom in coaching. I'm guaranteeing you, Tim, somebody out there is going to blossom in coaching in terms of this tournament.
Think about this, folks. If he ever gets out of the television business, he can collect finder's fees from young coaches. Dick Vitale, as NCAA Today continues here on ESPN, Loyola Marymount down by 15 at the half. Louisville had to handle that dreaded hyphen team in the first round. And when you're in the NCAAs, you don't want to play a team that's UALR. But that's who they had to play today. Louisville against Arkansas Little Rock. And Derek Owens on the break with a pull-up J baseline. Owens had 13 first-half points. Kenny Payne led the Ville in the first half. Here he gets the pass from LaBradford Smith. Was that one of Mom's Sunday best dishes? Payne had 12 in the first half. Second half, Keith Williams breaks free, slams it home. Now, the Trojans try to keep it close without Jeff Cummings, who had fouled out late, and it really hurt Mike Newell's team. Carl Brown with the steal. He'll get the layup. UALR had pulled it within three, but Louisville just simply would not crack. Never Nervous Burvis is free, and he finds Payne with a bounce pass. Louisville advances by a final score of 76-71 over Arkansas Little Rock. And remember, if Cummings had stayed in the game, that could have perhaps been an upset. Now, the Midwest regional brackets. Illinois is the top seed there. And that, of course, means Louisville moves on to play the winner of the Arkansas-Loyola Marymount game. It could be a rematch of the game, which was won in the Austin Superdrome by U.S. Reed with about a 60-footer. And, Dick, I know you remember that game. It was a game that Eddie Sutton had a fine Arkansas club. And Louisville, a lot of people figured, had a chance to repeat. That was the 1981 season, and they were coming off the 80 title.
They really did have a good basketball team. I don't like the way the Louisville team has played at the end of the year. I know they came on strong to win the Metro Conference, but their backcourt, to me, is still suspect. I really believe that, Tim, and I think ultimately with the importance the guard play at the postseason, that they can only go so far, and it's going to be bye-bye, baby. I really think they can run into a little problem if they have to play Arkansas's pressure, even though Arkansas is a very young basketball
team. Right, like you said, eventually, even if they played Illinois, they would have to deal with Kendall Gill, and Louisville has no Kendall Gills.
No contest if they play Illinois.
The
Illinois is
NCAA
super.
NCAA Today continues in a moment.
ESPN's NCAA Basketball, Arkansas versus Loyola Marymount, is brought to you by the new generation of Oldsmobile. Step into the future now at your Oldsmobile dealer. By Mr. Goodrich. Mr. Goodrich knows it's not just a car, it's your freedom. By Nike, who reminds you to just do it. And by new Michelob Dry. One taste and you'll drink it dry.
Tim Brando in our NCAA studios running a two-on-one fast break with John Saunders, both of us trying to endure Dickie V. Now let's take a look at some of the action taking place today between Louisiana Tech and LaSalle. In the first round of this tournament, one of the better matchups, really. Less than a minute to play, and LaSalle trying to close in. P.J. Brown with a long rebound in the outlet to Kennedy Lewis. The exclamation dunk, 83-74, the final score. Louisiana Tech with its fourth NCAA appearance in the decade of the 80s, and look at the Southeast Regional for a moment, and you'll see the good news is they won. The bad news is they'll play Oklahoma in round number two. So that's the situation there. Now, with respect to Arizona, this is a team that is the top seed playing out west and taking on Robert Morris. And first half action in Boise, Idaho, and the Wildcats on the fast break. Sean Elliott in the open court. He's devastating, isn't he? Right to Judd Bushler. Counted in a foul, a three-point play. Colonials coach Jarek Durham. The upset dreams are now a thing of the past. 84-55. Judd Bushler, by the way, has an ankle sprain and is not playing. Of course, they needn't have him for the remainder of that one. Back in a moment, Arkansas leading at halftime by 15. When you're chasing Oklahoma, the Sooners have Mookie Blaylock with three fouls. Here's John Sanders.
Rebounded away by Greg Dennis, and here in Nashville, Tennessee, a bit of a surprise brewing early, 8:45 to play. East Tennessee State leading Oklahoma by 11. The Sooners, who struggled in the Big 8 tournament, continue to struggle a bit here in the first round of the NCAA.
They started out, the Sooners, trying to go down and establish their inside game. After they went inside a few times, the Buccaneers started to drop people down inside, and it's going to be up to the outside shooting for Oklahoma to rescue this game, probably.
And Mookie Blaylock in foul trouble. He's on the bench. Keller gets it to Dennis. He slams it home. 10 points for Greg Dennis. And a 13-point Buccaneer lead.
Good job by Chad Keller that time, penetrating and then seeing the open man for the easy shot.
King missed everything, and then on the rebound, a foul call. The foul will go against Skeeter Henry of Oklahoma.
Watch Keller going in here, penetrate, gets his man up in the air, and then Dennis just comes in and stuffs it down.
Well, after Andre Wiley had moved away, there was nobody home.
Nope. That's what the penetration will do. It'll draw a defensive man to you and open up another player.
8 minutes remaining first half. 29-16 East Tennessee State.
Buccaneers have done a good job of getting out on the break. They are a running team, but for this game, they tried to hold it down, doing a good job of in a half-court offense.
They would still like it up in the 80s if they can get it there. They don't want it in the hundreds, though. Talford, hanging jumper won't go. Wiley with a rebound for Oklahoma. Moves it off to Mullins. He stopped, and it's Jennings back the other way to lay it in.
Well, things going wrong for the Sooners right now. The number four team in the country and the number one seed in this regional.
Down by...
It could be a Grand Ole upset in the home of the Grand Ole Opry. We'll keep you posted on that game, but now let's go back to Indy. Mick Hubert, Jim Gibbons, Loyola Marymount in Arkansas.
Mick Hubert along with Jim Gibbons, 11:04 to go, second half. The Lions, as close as they have been in the second half, they're down only 10 here. They've trailed in the first half by as many as 18. They're not shooting well, but they're still launching the missiles. Pair Steamer with a miss. Rebound Wilson. The outlet to Mayberry. Here come the Hogs back. Bowers comes back to Wilson. Bowers, 14-footer. Rebound Ferguson.
You'll notice Arkansas is taking more time in their half-court offense the last 20 minutes than they did in the first 20.
There's a walk against Tom Peabody. The crowd doesn't like it here. But, that's
well, the crowd has kind of picked up, and they're cheering really for Loyola Marymount.
And look at this.
Wow.
East Tennessee State.
I'll tell you, look at that.
Early with a 15-point lead against the Oklahoma Sooners.
I don't care how early it is. When you can hold Oklahoma to 16 points, that's not bad.
I think there might be some three-point shots.
Wow.
That's a nice drive by Mayberry, but he left it short, and then a whistle and a foul.
See, the really difficult thing for LMU is at the end of a game, if Hank is in there, and my God, he's your leading scorer and leading rebounder, but also a 57% free throw shooter, and then that's a double-edged sword.
10:23 left, and it's Arkansas leading by 10.
Shoot that. Seven footer from Paris, France has not had it going well, but he's been sitting there a long time. That's a tough time to come into a game like this.
Keefe hits the front end. His 21st point.
Mark Brown's a 79% free throw shooter.
Now Keefe to try to tie it with 34 seconds left. And he's got it. So Keefe ties the season high with 22. And a timeout on the floor with 34 seconds to play. The score, Siena 78 and Stanford 78 will be...
All right, so there you see it. It's all tied up at 78 apiece. And Dick Vitale, it is amazing to some, but not so amazing to those of us that have been following Siena throughout the course of this year.
Well, we talked about it earlier. Beating Pittsburgh certainly proves they can flat-out play. But I really believe right now the strategy's got to be knowing their personnel in their backcourt is to take it down to about 3 to 4 seconds and let Brown shoot the ball. Even though he's missed 2 1-on-1s, he's a tremendous shooter. He's having a fantastic game. I would put the rock in his hands, and I'll tell you one thing. They better win this game now, Siena, because if it goes to overtime, the advantage definitely has to go to Stanford coming from behind.
And remember this, the perimeter jump shot is not a bad idea. They are 11 out of 22 from three-point range, so...
Well, I wouldn't think three right now, Timmy. I think that you can think a higher percentage shot than that.
Just an outside shot, though, because they do have that great backcourt. They have not been a front court team all year.
No, they're a perimeter team, but also on the other end, not shocked with the performance of Adam Keefe. Mm-hmm. He said no to Dean Smith in North Carolina. They wanted him badly. He's one of the great recruits that Stanford signed many a year. Keefe is having a big day off the bench. He's in the 20, better than 20 points, big, strong inside player. Mm-hmm. So he's been a factor off the bench. But I look for Brown, milk the clock, Mike Dean, either become a star, go to the next round, and maybe have some people begging him to move up, or you go home, pack up the bags, and get ready for some baseball.
Hey, we've got a few more cut-ins coming up, including this one, East Tennessee State and Oklahoma. It's now 39-31 at the half, East Tennessee State with the lead. Let's get back to Bob Ruthven. It's all tied up in Greensboro.
The scoreboard story in Greensboro, North Carolina. Stanford 78, Siena 78, and 34 seconds remaining. Siena with the ball, and Stanford will drop back into a half-court defense. The Saints have gone cold from the line, coming down the stretch. And now it is Mark Brown going to work.
And it is Lichty on him. That's how the great games are supposed to end. No gimmicks here. 15 seconds. They've got to get the ball in this man's hands. And Siena's basketball destiny is in his hands right here.
Siena going for the upset win. It's Brown. He's fouled. Lichty banged him on top of the head with 3 seconds to go. And Brown to the line.
Well, the mismatch in that matchup was speed. Mike Dean looks amazingly calm. But watch the move. He turns the corner. A little bit of a screen. He sees daylight. Not enough weak side defense. No question there was a foul. Boy, the little guy's got after Burns. He's already missed the front end of 2 1-and-1 free throws to give his team a little bit of pad. And this is called ice the shooter. And that is the last Stanford timeout.
Siena has 2 timeouts remaining. Sophomore Mark Brown at the line with a chance for Siena a victory. We'll be back.
Back to Bob and Bucky in a moment, but we're all tied at 78. Stay with us. Well, the coach called it. Mark Brown gets his chance. Remember, Mark Brown has missed both of his last 1-and-1 opportunities.
I say he's gold right now. I think the kid's a pressure kind of player. I think he wanted the rock, as you've seen at the end of the game, and he is going to deliver it.
All right, we'll soon see. Back to Bob Rathbun and Bucky Waters for the telling seconds.
3 seconds left. The Siena students holding hands here, praying, I guess, in unison. 78 aside, 3 seconds remain. And Mark Brown, the 5'11 sophomore, 0 for 2 at the line, and the toothpick that stirs the drink for Siena. Chance to be the hero. Now Mike Dean takes a timeout. Siena by 1. This telecast presented by authority of the NCAA. Any use of this program without written consent is prohibited. The announcers for this program have been approved and contracted by NCAA Productions. Now, with 1 second left, rather 3 seconds left, and a 1-point lead, Brown at the line to shoot one more foul shot.
Well, I think the timeout's very interesting because Stanford was out of them. Obviously, he's not concerned about icing his shooter, despite the fact he's only 1 for 2 down the stretch. He made another substitution during that timeout, going with the 7-footer, the senior, Eric Fleur, who's really not been that effective. And you got to remember, with 3 seconds to go, that Stanford's going to get the ball back. They're either going to get it off a miss, which means they can't call timeout, and they got to go the length of the floor in 3 seconds. And the possibility of that 3-point shot, the one that Danny Ferry almost made in the Atlantic Coast Conference Tournament, a lot of things can happen here, but it's going to have to go from 3-point land if this guy can make this one for Stanford to win. He looked a lot more confident that time on the line. Key here is Stanford, no more timeouts, make or miss.
And make or miss, a 3-point beat you. So yep. Dean, no doubt, is telling his players, you've got to get in the shooter's face somehow.
They will come down with a very soft press, and the last thing he said was, don't foul.
Brown hits them both for 32 points. Now, Stanford going for the win here. A 3-pointer by Taylor. No good. Siena's done it. They've upset Stanford. Score in Greensboro, the Siena Saints 80 and the Stanford Cardinal 78.
There you have it. They just got their new nickname, and the Saints go marching on to game number two of the NCAA tournament. And you called it a clear out for Mark Brown to get to the free throw line.
Well, you got to put the ball in the hands of your great player. But you know what was interesting? How well coached they were? He converts the two free throws, and they get a guy up right on the baseline so they can't enter the ball like what happened to Indiana against Illinois. I think if Bobby Knight had to do it again, he would have put a guy on the baseline to stop the entry pass that went to Mr. Anderson to win the game for Illinois. Great coaching by Michael Dean. You are a star today in the tournament. Mike Dean and Siena.
And remember, they were able to tune out those fans for six games to have this moment of joy with all of their fans. We'll be taking you back to the Loyola Marymount Arkansas game when we come back. Tim Brando, along with Dick Vitale in our NCAA studios. Oklahoma has just taken its first lead in the game moments ago. Let's join John Saunders and Gary Thompson in Nashville, Tennessee. It's a wild one.
At this point in the game, he knows that he has to stay in the ballgame. Is that important to his club? Tubbs liking the play. Assistant coach Jim Kerwin there and the glasses coming up.
Here's the situation, a minute and 21 seconds left. Oklahoma, just moments ago, got the lead for the first time in the game. The Sooners on the basket by Blaylock, lead by one, 72-71. Blaylock will go to the line. Keith Mr. Jennings, the playmaker, the leader for East Tennessee State, has fouled out of the ball game. So coming on to replace him will be Major Gear. The Sooners trailed the entire ball game. They were down by 17 in the first half. Oklahoma trailed by 8 at halftime. They've gradually worked themselves back into it thanks to the play of Stacey King, who has 28, and a strong second half for William Davis. Blaylock also strong in the second half with 12 of his 15 points. Bending off. Davis touched it last. So with a minute 20 to go, Billy Tubbs and the Sooners will see the Buccaneers with the basketball.
And see if the Buccaneers use the clock. They could get two possessions here to one to Oklahoma.
Only a one-point difference. This is Talford. He'll penetrate, give it back to Keller.
Some good athletes with a lot of quickness. A lot of guys can put the ball on the floor. Talford's one if he can get you in the foul situation.
Here's Dennis using the glass up high, trying to follow the shot. They go to the court.
Davis.
Held ball.
Big hit. Ooh. Possession to Buccaneers.
Davis battling hard, but let's also give some credit to Greg Dennis. He went after that missed shot.
Well, there's no time to be timid now, even if you got some foul problems. Right now, 56 seconds. I'm going to say Oklahoma, regardless of what happens, is going to get a possession.
Two timeouts remaining for East Tennessee State. Billy Tubbs and the Sooners have all three of their timeouts remaining. 56 seconds to play, and there's one of the timeouts taken there by Major Gear. 56 seconds to go. It's Oklahoma 72, East Tennessee State 71.
All right, so John Saunders, what a miracle for him to be there. He's got to come in here at 7 o'clock. 72-71, Oklahoma with the lead. And don't forget, if East Tennessee State pulls this off, it will be the second major upset of the day because Siena took on Stanford earlier today. We're going to show you what happened in that basketball game, and it was a wild one. Todd Lickney shaken up early on, but no ill effects. Late in the first half, Siena up by one. Mark Brown will draw the defense, find Steve Downey for the slam. Watch Brown with the penetration here. Oh, he drives, he draws, he dishes, as Dickie V would say. Second half, Saints are now on a run. The pass is going to come inside to Steve McCoy. Watch him take it inside the paint with authority. Counted in the foul. 61-45. They're up 16. Stanford comes storming back with Lichty back in the lineup. A three-pointer here. No neck sprain now. Cardinal down by only five. Then late in the game, Adam Keith down low. Hits it. He's fouled. Suddenly the game tied at 76. But with 3 seconds left, watch what they pull off here. After a clear out and a foul, Mark Brown had missed his first two in one-and-one situations, but he buried that one. He hits both, and Siena is marching in 80-78. Now, we're going to show you now the bracket in the Eastern Regional. Minnesota, a victor over Kansas State. That means Siena will play against them West Virginia and Tennessee yet to come tonight here on ESPN. Now, in Nashville, Tennessee, Oklahoma, and East Tennessee State, it's a one-point game.
Tennessee State has been hanging on at the foul line because they haven't been able to make any field goals.
Well, I think the zone started the thing. It took them out of the rhythm of their offense. Then when they made a little run, Oklahoma went back man for man. But since then, they really haven't had the good movement in their offense.
And with a new 45 on the shot clock, see how much of the time they take before they decide to take the shot.
Well, in this case, I don't think with 10 or 11 seconds, you've got to make sure right now the score and the time in the game that you get a good shot. You couldn't worry now about getting a shot off in 10 seconds. It has to be a good one. I look for some penetration here. Look to try to pick up the foul.
Keller comes out to help Palford. Now he hands it back to Alvin West. Remember, Jennings is on the bench. He's fouled out. That is a key.
Right.
20 seconds to play in the game. Here's jumper is short.
What a foul.
Dennis. It'll be Oklahoma ball with 11 seconds to play. The Sooners up by one.
Oklahoma has to make sure they put the hands in the ball with somebody who can shoot the free throw. Blaylock, 65% free throw shooter. They got to foul it.
They did. It comes with 8 seconds to play. Blaylock will go to the line, and even if he makes two, it'll give one final chance to East Tennessee State. That foul was charged to Major Gear. His first, and Blaylock to the line. For in the ball game this afternoon, he has made 5 out of 7. Missed his last one, however. Right? 8 seconds remaining. Oklahoma trying to advance against Louisiana Tech.
Let's see if Oklahoma, if he makes the free throws, let's see if they get a timeout call after the make. Big miss.
Tipped up, no Davis. Good. Rebound by East Tennessee State. They take timeout. The timeout called before the interception. 2 seconds to play, and East Tennessee State is going to get one more shot at them. Oklahoma by one. It's OU 72, East Tennessee State 71.
So it's 72-71, but there may be more than 2 seconds left. We'll check on that while we break away. We'll return to Nashville, Tennessee. East Tennessee State, Oklahoma. There's our score. We have 2 seconds left, Dick.
I'm really shocked looking at what we saw. I thought for sure they'd have a little more. Throw the ball up the sideline and try to get the quick shot from the sideline.
All right, let's get back now to John Sanders in Nashville.
It's a one-point Oklahoma lead, but let's look at the last shot and keep your eye on the clock and the sound.
Well, Blaylock misses it. Probably one of the best misses that Oklahoma ever had will be right there on the tip-in by Davis because it took a lot of time off the clock. You see right here, the clock's still running, the timeout call there. It looked like it was on 4, or you get the...
The timeout call definitely came at 4, maybe 3. Oklahoma takes timeout. The Sooners have 2 remaining. East Tennessee State has none remaining. As you look at it, you could either say 4 or possibly 3. As it is, they have 2. Now, what's the key on the inbound play?
Well, to me, the key on his inbound play is to put a big man on the ball so that he cannot just have free access or reign to throw the pass and make a good pass. I think you have, that's the start of it. I think you have to have good pressure on that guy. Put my biggest guy right there and jumper. And the guy's taking the ball out of bounds. And then you have to think, don't foul. Try and lead up your people and make them come get the basketball. Come out as high as you can. But you cannot give the back cutter away.
They put the clock back to 4, exactly where we thought it should be. So that at least will give them a little bit of a cushion. Now watch it again. And listen for the whistle and look at the clock and the timeout call.
Like the whistle and the 4 is probably right. I'm surprised that we come out to play and then after the timeout was called and went back and is, would that be an interesting thing?
Well, trust me, nobody came over to look at the replays, so you don't have that to worry about.
And that's one thing. Well, they've got a standby official over there, and one of his jobs is to check the clock in these kind of situations. That maybe the individual they went to made the decision. But again, I'm surprised that we came up to put the ball in play and the timeout was called, that it wasn't corrected before that.
Our thanks to NCAA Basketball Committee Representative Ken Free and Tournament Manager Ken Hudgens along with tournament media coordinator Lou Harris from East Tennessee State, the athletic director.
They've really played well.
We have 4 seconds remaining here. I'm John Sanders along with Gary Thompson. 72-71 Oklahoma. They led only twice here in the last few seconds of the game. Other than that, it's been all East Tennessee State, up by as many as 17, led by 8 at halftime. But slowly but surely, and thanks in good part, I think, to the play of William Davis and Mookie Blaylock in the second half, the Sooners have gotten back in it.
That's right. Davis inside. They went the inside game. He's real strong. Had a key follow shot of his own miss and put it back in. It was really important. There you see the timeouts left.
Well, twice before, when everybody is reset, the Sooners have called timeout. Let's see if we're going to play this time with 4 seconds to go. We are.
Tough place to get the pass right there.
There's the shot.
Got a block, got a piece of it, and the Sooners escape.
Exactly right. Oklahoma will move on to play Louisiana Tech. A squeaker, Stacey King, a strong ball game, 28 points for the All-American. Mookie Blaylock with 15, William Davis with 14. Handshakes at half court, a strong effort for East Tennessee State. The Buccaneers and Oklahoma played it well on the inbound play.
Well, they got Bell, their best leaper there. I think you got to try if you can to get that pass up court, because look at the time he eat up. 1 second to play and he's taking a 35-footer.
So a nice run for the folks from Johnson City, but there was a 7-minute drought in scoring from the floor. Jennings and Dennis both got into foul difficulty, and that had a lot to do with Oklahoma's run, and Stacey King certainly came through down the stretch.
Well, he's the All-American, but I really, if I were coaching right now, East Tennessee State, I'd be so disappointed at the last attempt to get a shot. Putting the ball in the center of the court made it very difficult. I agree with Gary Thompson. The ball should have went up the sideline, but they gallant effort. I'll tell you this, Timmy, we said it earlier. Oklahoma is not playing well. Colorado, struggle city without Blaylock. Struggle city against Iowa State. Beaten by Missouri. I really believe the distractions, the problems with Blaylock have affected that team, and unless they get it together, it's going to end the season a lot earlier than they anticipated.
Mookie Blaylock only had 3 points at halftime of that game, and he was also in foul difficulty throughout most of that game. But Oklahoma advances to make
it. Now, don't attack that trap now with this lead.
St. Mary's needing some points. They need him relatively quickly. Clemson trying to shut the three off. You can see where their defense is. They're outside that three-point line.
Clemson's really stretched the defense. You picked that up well, Ted. Pushed it out.
If they do that, shouldn't St. Mary's just go for the two? Get the two.
Drop it inside, go for the easy one, then try to call timeout. You're right.
Instead, Lewis had a shot blocked, and now they foul.
Sometimes I think teams make a mistake, as you very well saw in the game, trying to go for that 3 point under a lot of pressure when they can kick it in and get
so
a sure two.
So tempting, isn't it? So tempting.
Very, very tempting.
And Clemson now has blocked 12 shots in this game, and I can remember at least three of them being 3 point shots that they blocked.
The big guy even moved out one time on St. Mary's and knocked one back.
Tim Beret, the Associate Sports Information Director at Clemson, who we need to thank for his help, gave us the Clemson free throw shooting stats in the last 5 minutes. And Marion Cash is the guy that doesn't show up very well on that. And he's calmly made three in a row here.
Now, you know him very well. Do you think he made a mistake on that? Or is this Cash here?
He is a living legend. He makes no mistakes.
That's an endorsement you like, Billy.
We need to thank also Rick Sutton, the Sports Information Director from St. Mary's College, for their help. Von Tour. Missing by Daly, and Davis rebounds it with 22 seconds to play, and a foul which now appears to give Clemson a road to the second round in a meeting with Arizona here on Saturday.
Ever scrapping St. Mary's, still trying to get into this ball game. Clemson has the type of team, Lynn Nance there winding up an excellent year, that can really play with a team like Arizona on a given night. They have the athletes to go up and down the floor. Defensively, they have the shot blockers. We saw that. Looks like a pretty good matchup.
Clemson pulling everybody off the line. The one and one here for Davis.
One shot.
And Davis has been a very good foul shooter, 70% in the last 5 minutes of games.
And how do you plug into the factor that Clemson maybe had their nervousness over the hump game today in Arizona? Not really under much pressure from Robert Morris.
Well, Cliff Ellis was an interesting observer, a part of Arizona's workout yesterday.
Very interesting. A lot of questions, isn't
he? He was hoping he'd have a chance to play, and St. Mary's certainly made it look today like their Tigers wouldn't get to that game. But Clemson's superior inside play simply dominated this game in the second half as Derek Forrest goes the length of the court. And the Clemson Tigers win their first NCAA game since 1980. And they end a Cinderella year for the St. Mary's Gales, who won 25 games. But it's Cliff Ellis who takes his Clemson Tigers to the second round to meet Arizona as Clemson wins here by a final score of 83-70.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to our NCAA Tournament Tonight studios. I'm John Saunders, taking over for Tim Brando. So the regular season champions from the WCAC, St. Mary's, now they are gone. They joined the tournament champions from the WCAC, Loyola Marymount. They lost earlier today. And Dick Vitale, we have to ask, two teams going in from that conference, ousted rather easily. Is that a surprise at all?
Well, not really a shock to me at all. I think when you rate those conferences and you take the computer and utilize the computer ranking, John, you'd find out that they don't rank up there with the prestigious conferences throughout America. I thought St. Mary's gave a gallant effort defensively, but they didn't have enough inside. Eldon Campbell has potential to be a star. There's only one guy that stops Campbell from going to the next step, and that's Eldon Campbell's work ethic and his desire. He's got to be a little bit more hungrier, and if he is, he can be a great player.
Clemson looked flat against Virginia in the ACC tournament, but really coming into the ACC tournament, they were very hot. They had knocked off Duke down the stretch, Georgia Tech as well, so they're a good team.
John, they do exceptionally well at home. They play brilliant basketball on their floor. The problem for Cliff Ellis's basketball team has been, can they win away from home? And I think right now that setup with Arizona is very interesting. They're a very dangerous team because they have some great athletes. The kid Davis inside is a big-time Windex man. I mean, he sweeps the glass. He could chew it up. He had 21 rebounds against North Carolina. Arizona's going to have to come to play, and Arizona's going to have to be really ready because Clemson has enough athletes to make it exciting.
Arizona, the number one seed, advanced earlier today, and let's talk about what happened in the East in Greensboro. It was Siena and Stanford. This one might surprise you. Hang on and wait and see what happened here. Stanford, the Cardinal, and the fans were on hand for the Siena Saints. Mark Brown with the shake and bake and the three-pointer. Siena was up by six. Stanford comes back, though. Adam Keefe gets his own rebound, goes up for the two, and he's fouled. Stanford goes ahead by one. 46 seconds left in the half. Mark Brown powers it to Steve Down, who jams it down, and the game is tied 37-37. Second half, Jeff Robinson for Siena, one of his six three-pointers. Siena is up by 10. Stanford would not let up. The Cardinal, Terry Taylor for the two. The game's tied at 66. 1:27 remaining in the game. Mark Brown lets it fly, and the Saints are up by a deuce, 78-76, after two free throws. Mark Brown gets fouled on the drive with 3 seconds remaining. He makes both of the free throws. Stanford, no time left, and they try to put up a prayer, and there is no prayer, really, because as he knocks down both shots, Siena has the upset of Stanford, 80-78. This was just elemental as it was coming down the final seconds of the game. Siena, the Saints, advance with the victory over the Stanford Cardinal, the number three seed in the East. The game being played in Greensboro, 80-78 was the final. Mark Brown did hit the two free throws. He had missed a couple earlier, and when he went to the line, he said, yes, it was on his mind.
All I had in my mind was choke. I'm the leader on this team, and you know what? I've been shooting about 80% all year, and when I missed the two free throws, I just was hoping I could get to the line again and just make it up to the team and our fans.
He did not choke. He did hit the shots. What impressed me about this game, Siena's up by 16, and over the course of about 1 minute and 30 seconds, Stanford cut the lead down to three, and Siena didn't fold at all. They really held their composure.
Stanford did a great job to get back in the game. Very physical team. Adam Keefe, remember the name, John. He's going to be a star player in the Pac-10. Big, strong, wide body inside. Great coming off the bench. But I was impressed also with the way Brown went to that free throw line. And I'll tell you what else impressed me. The coaching during the timeout. They get the TO, they get the timeout, and then the beautiful coaching job to isolate and put the ball in the hands of Brown with 3 seconds to go. And then he goes to the line, he says, give me the rock, and he delivers that sucker, just like you would. I tell you, he went to the line, just like you take that hockey stick. I watched you on our show.
Shocking.
I've worked with you long enough to know that you need the pat on the back when you deserve it. You called this. You really thought Stanford was a little soft going in.
Well, I thought they were a little soft. I had them in that game in the Pac-10 against Arizona, and they didn't look impressive at all, their quickness and their speed. And I thought coming in, they didn't have any kind of momentum. But I also was impressed, not to take anything away from Siena, about the Siena basketball team, that they can beat Pittsburgh at Pittsburgh and take Florida at Florida to the buzzer before losing. And Mark Brown and Robinson have proven they can shoot the ball. I think we're going to see a new star born as a coach. Michael Dean's name could start to pop up a la Tom Pender's last year in some jobs. And now they have the matchup with Minnesota. Minnesota's got to be smiling a little bit getting Siena, but I'll tell you what, those kids Brown and Robinson could make it exciting again for Minnesota.
Everyone expected that the second round action would be Kansas State and Stanford. Well, those of you that expected that, you're in for a surprise. Minnesota playing Kansas State. Minnesota was the lower seed of the two coming in. Lon Kruger leads his team to the third consecutive tournament, and Clem Haskins has his club in there. First time ever under him. Ray Gaffney cans the top of the key, a three-pointer. Minnesota up seven early. Willie Burton, after the missed shot, is there for the tip-in. 18 in the first half for Burton. He did it from outside as well. Works his way free just before halftime, and the Gophers are up by 10 at the half. Second half, Burton with the miss. Kevin Lynch grabs the offensive rebound and scores among the trees. He had 10 in the second half. Some anxious moments for the Gophers. They turn it over. Lakeith Humphrey takes it in for the hoop. The Wildcats cut the margin to five, and Clem Haskins says things are getting a little too tight. Melvin Newberg takes care of that. With a three-pointer, Minnesota's up by eight. And then Steve Hansen was off. He's usually hot from out there in the three-point range, but he could not get them to fall. 86-75. The Golden Gophers have the win and advance to the second round with a victory over Kansas State. Willie Burton had 29 points of the game. Steve Hansen did have 24 points for Kansas State, but certainly not enough. So let us take a look at the bracket in Greensboro. Minnesota with the win over K-State, and Siena with the win over Stanford. That's right. It will be Minnesota and Siena in the second round, the number 11 seed facing the number 14 seed. And it just goes to show, Dick, that in this tournament, your buddy up at NC State, Valvano, says it's America, anyone can win, and there's your example.
My buddy? I just was on a phone with him a little while ago, and he's all over my case. He says, Vital, you know you want to coach Michigan. Valvano, you're a wacko. I'm undefeated, baby, and I want no part of it. But, you know, talking about Minnesota, they had the tough break when they lost Richard Coffey. He went down, but the team seemed to regroup. On the other side, you look at Ohio State, and Ohio State, you would definitely think they'd be part of this party, the team that could have been in a Sweet 16 potentially with Mr. Burson. But they lose Burson. They, Elfoldo, couldn't get the job done to get into the NCAA tournament. But Minnesota hung in there, and they made it up losing Coffey, and he was a big loss, a big-time rebounder.
And you really have to applaud Clem Haskins and the job he's done.
Job.
He comes in there. A lot of controversy at that program a few years ago off the basketball court. He shunted all that aside and done a great job.
Clem Haskins is an outstanding person. I really love him. I'll tell you one thing. I got to know Clem quite well when he was at Western Kentucky, and he's done an amazing job when you think about the league he's in. They have so many heavyweights when you talk of Michigan, Indiana, Iowa, Illinois. I mean, that league is loaded, baby. That's Michael Tyson's. There's no Frank Bruno's there.
All right, there's still plenty more to come here on ESPN's NCAA Tonight. We're just halfway through our Thursday.
Bucky Waters in Greensboro, West Virginia 63 and Tennessee 48, 7:56 remaining. And freshman Tracy Shelton stepping up to the foul line for West Virginia. Coming in for Tennessee, number 34, Ronnie Reeks, a sophomore from Franklin, Virginia. Shelton averages 6.5 points per game. This is his first opportunity at the line. An outstanding three-point threat. First-year man from Oak Hill, West Virginia.
He can actually play one or two guard. He's really going to be a good one.
2 points for Shelton. 65-48. West Virginia trying to move to the round of 32 and doing it with relative ease here. 7:50 to play. Long bomb, no. Rebounded by Tennessee. Knicks had it taken right away from him by Herbie Brooks. Brooks had that pivot foot nailed to the floor, and now we've got a travel on Jackson.
Looking at that defense for West Virginia, it was some kind of a zone. It could have been a box and one. There wasn't enough movement by Bell, but they definitely have gone to a zone. They want the Volunteers to prove it from the perimeter, except for Bell. let you know.
They're
just wonderful. They are hardcore. They will follow you.
A minute 15, breakaway to Berger. Bounce pass to Chris Brooks, puts it in to put an exclamation point and a solid West Virginia win.
Well, the 10-day layoff obviously didn't hurt the Mountaineers. They had a chance to regroup, recharge, and they've been very impressive this evening. They just never let the Volunteers of Tennessee get started.
Brooks way short with that one.
He's still pondering that as the orange jerseys fly by.
Roth bidding for his third three-pointer of the game, and he's got it. 79-66. West Virginia to meet the winner of the Duke-South Carolina State game. That's the final game of the day here at the Greensboro Coliseum.
This game was so anticlimactic after that great Siena win over Stanford, which went right to the buzzer. This was a tough, that was a tough act to follow. This game just didn't fulfill it. We thought this game would be very close, very competitive. Just didn't work that way.
43 seconds. Steve Berger will be going to the foul line now for West Virginia.
Gale Catlett says he wishes he was nastier. Such a nice kid. You like your point guard to be a leader, a general, a tough cookie. And Steve Berger is just one of those really genuinely nice, gentle people from Boomer, West Virginia. Just a junior at 5'11", an outstanding baseball prospect.
Berger putting in the foul shot, his 12th point of the game. The Mountaineers have placed five in double figures. Shelton did it coming off the bench. ...81-66. Nix connects. Two-point shot. Dyren with 22. He's had seven in the second half. And Berger will again shoot a 1-1. Earlier here today, Minnesota with the victory over Kansas State. And Minnesota Club Haskins trying to figure out a way to stop Siena. And Mark Brown, their lightning quick point guard. The night bracket begins with this West Virginia victory over Tennessee, and a lot of long faces on that Volunteer bench. Berger hit a foul shot for his 12th point. Don DeVos club down 82-68. Well, Kirby Brooks going out of the game, and coming in will be Chris Leonard for West Virginia. Well, Gale Catlett taking the opportunity to get a few folks in the box score. A minute remaining.
31, got him, 31.
Nix with the personal foul.
Illinois 77, McNeese State 71.
West Virginia will move on with a record of 26-4. And with that kind of mark, it's a long and storied basketball heritage in Morgantown. And this has to go down as one of the finest seasons with that 22-game winning streak and now into the round of 32. Kroger to the line. Thomas, a freshman from Gainesville, Florida. Now 1-for-8 from the line this year. Ahead to Griffin. And coming out of there with it is Leonard. 13 seconds left. Chris Brooks backs it in.
Mercifully, this one's over.
The final seconds tick away, and West Virginia has a win in the NCAA tournament. The final score, the Mountaineers 84, and the Tennessee Volunteers 68.
The Tennessee Volunteers really never stepped forward, if you will, to play in this one. They did not want to volunteer. They were down big early and stayed down. West Virginia will advance. Now, elsewhere in the Midwest, being played in Indianapolis, the Fighting Illini of Illinois and McNeese State. The Illini come in as the top seed, much to the chagrin of Bobby Knight, who's a number two seed out west. But Michael Cutright here drives, shoots the fadeaway. McNeese State has the early lead. The Illini led by five at the half, only five. Second half, Kenny Battle takes control. Strong move. And he's fouled. Three-point play. Illinois now up by 16. And the show starts to continue. Larry Smith looking for Nick Anderson on the lob. 62-43 at that point. And the Fighting Illini are the Flying Illini once again as they win it 77-71. They'll play the winner of Ball State and Pitt now in the Midwest, also being played in Indianapolis, Arkansas, Little Rock, and Louisville. Louisville a winner by just five as Kenny Payne had 17 points. And Loyola Marymount facing the Razorbacks of Arkansas. Arkansas ran with them and ran them to death. Down by 19 was the final, 120-101, as Mario Credit had a career-high 34 points. So, in the Midwest, being played at Indianapolis, Illinois awaiting the winner of Pitt, Ball State, a game you'll see most of here on ESPN a little later, and Arkansas will face Louisville. And Dick Vitale, we have to ask who's coming. Illinois, they look so lethargic. They blow out Michigan, they blow out Iowa in their own conference and come in and struggle against McNeese State.
Well, you know, they looked really good, I thought, in the second half. They got the Flying Illini attack going. But then you got to give some credit to McNeese State. That kid Cartwright can really play. The guard is outstanding. But I thought that they did what they had to do to win, setting up a potential heck of a match. Pittsburgh, one of my real sleepers in that division. You know, Pittsburgh's been a giant killer. They've been able to beat a Georgetown. They beat an Oklahoma. They beat Syracuse at the Carrier Dome. But they lost to a Siena. But Siena now has proven that they're a legitimate basketball team, a solid goal basketball team. So I don't know. Pittsburgh, if they get by Ball State, should get by Ball State. Ball State saying, wait a minute now. We only have two losses. We have the best record going. But if Brian Shorter and company come to play with their basketball team, all Souths, next year, Pittsburgh could be one of the real darlings of college basketball.
All sophomores, as you say. Pitt is one of those teams that you're not really sure exactly what they're going to do. They're good enough to beat in Illinois, but they could also lose to Ball State in round one. We'll find out in just a moment. Stay with us. More scores and highlights coming up, though. Providence and Virginia, that one ahead, and that one is a good one. Your final score in the East.
Late game situations. Rick Barnes has a word with him. He may have been designated to foul somebody and didn't get the job done.
No, Morgan, 83.8%, second in Atlantic Coast Conference. But what he's done before doesn't matter. It's what he does now.
Morgan, 31 points in the ballgame. He shot him like that from the line all night long. I've got him at 8 for 8. Is that correct? 8 straight at the line.
Well, this is a big one for Virginia because the worst you can do is get a tie. Unless you've got a foul behind a three-point.
Virginia takes the timeout. Now each team has one remaining. Time for Rick Barnes to scratch his head, talk to Herb Sendick a bit, and go back to work. It's 100-97. Virginia is leading Providence. Terry Holland's club trying to advance in this NCAA championship. 2 years ago, Providence advanced all the way to the Final Four.
And these two clubs way over their averages. Virginia averaging 81 offensively, and Providence about 85. Here we are on a 197-point game.
We'll get you back there for the final seconds in just a moment, but let us update what's happening in the East being played at Greensboro, North Carolina. Duke facing South Carolina State. South Carolina State won the MEAC on this floor, so whose advantage is it? Duke's Quinn Snyder makes the steal on the double team and leads it to Phil Henderson. Duke has the lead, but South Carolina State is hanging in there. It's just 31-22, that game being played in the first half. Right now, let's get back to Providence and Virginia. The final seconds being played in Nashville, Tennessee.
They are getting set to come out and play the next game. .197 is the score. The Friars come back out and we'll see how Rick Barnes elects to play it, how he's going to run his offense. They're going to get some pressure from Virginia, which is a good idea.
Make them take some time off the clock. Well, they just show pressure and they drop back. See if they set man for man. They're staying in their man for man defense.
They're all right. Palazzi for three. He's got it. It's out. Foster with a rebound. 2 seconds. Palazzi for three. Bending up. Tipped up. No good. Ball game's over. Matt Palazzi had two cracks at it. Couldn't get it to go.
Two pretty good cracks, too. Can't ask for much more than that.
What a tremendous basketball game. It is won by the Cavaliers of Virginia. Final score, Virginia 100, Providence 97. Palazzi had his chance.
Matt Palazzi with two last-second shots at the three-pointer. He can't get it, and the Virginia Cavaliers have advanced against Providence. So let us take a look at that region and how Virginia has gotten there and exactly who they will be up against. They'll face the winner of Florida State and Middle Tennessee State. Oklahoma and Louisiana Tech are already there. A reminder, we will get to the Ball State-Pittsburgh game in just a moment. But first, let's talk about what a great game that was between Providence and Virginia. But Providence, off to such a great start early in the year, they really did struggle down the stretch.
Phenomenal game. But, you know, in fairness right now, you talk about Providence struggling down the stretch. They lost to some great basketball teams, losing to the Georgetowns and the Syracuses. They jumped out to the great run early, but the only really what I would call quality win was the win over South Alabama with that great backcourt, peanut butter and jelly. Watch out, Wim Sanderson. You better get ready for peanut butter and jelly because they can play. Tremendous game, John. Just a great game.
Virginia proved all year they could play at home in the ACC, but now playing outside of the ACC and not at home at Virginia, obviously, they can pull off some wins as well. Still to come, Ball State and Pitt in just a moment. A lot of people don't know this. They won more games than any team in the country this year.
Well, they also beat Minnesota at Minnesota. And Rick Majerus' team plays outstanding defense. I've talked to some coaches, John, that are from that conference, and they have told me they flat out can guard people. And they have two players, the kid Kidd and McGurdy, also played with Arkansas Little Rock, the team that beat Notre Dame 2 years ago. Experienced basketball team. Billy Butts also is a transfer from out of Michigan. And Rick Majerus, you got to like the little round mouth. I mean, I love that big, heavyset guy on the sideline.
Is it the side? Or what's on top of his
head
that you
like
the most?
I like his ball, no, but he could also coach. I clap my hands again. My wife's going to slap me in the face.
That's all right. She'll really slap you if we don't get out to the game. Ball State and Pittsburgh coming out. Let's join Tom Hammonds in the Midwest.
32-29, Ball State leading Pittsburgh with 2:15 left. In the first half of play, Jason Matthews has led the Pitt comeback. They once trailed by 14.
Here he is, knocking it down from behind the arc. Nothing but strength.
The Panthers on a 10-0 roll at the moment with 2:15 left in the half. They're doing all this without their leading scorer and rebounder, Brian Shorter, who's on the bench after picking up three quick fouls.
Now a little full court pressure out of the timeout by the Panthers.
Ball State has played into Pittsburgh's hands on the comeback by hitting a scoring drought of their own. Rick Majerus gets Greg Miller back into the game. He was a super sub earlier in the half, came off the bench to pick up nine. Under the 2 minute mark of the half.
Cardinals have to look to probe the seams of this 1-2-2.
Fox had to alter his shot and missed it, then a rebounding foul. It's going to be on Curtis Kidd of Ball State, his second.
Here's the penetration. Tough off-balance shot by Butts. And there we could. Here we get the foul right there. Curtis Kidd over the back.
Surprised if they didn't exhaust this clock trying to get the last shot. Maybe try to get back a little of the momentum they've lost over the last 6 minutes of this first half.
Ball State began the first 5 minutes of the game by hitting about 67%. At one time, it opened up a 14-point lead. Pitt closed it to one a few moments ago, and now with time ticking away, it's a 34-31 advantage for Ball State. They'll hold it for the final shot. You see the clock at 10 seconds.
Look to get into their set right now.
Butts for three. Yes! 1 second left. Matthews can't get a shot away. So Ball State weathers a mini drought. They get a three-pointer from Butts right before halftime. And at the intermission, the score, Ball State 37, Pittsburgh 31. We'll be back.
Ball State had a big lead, but they still do hang on to go into the locker room with the lead over Pitt. Pitt started slowly. Brian Shorter with three fouls in the first 10 minutes of the game. Let's go to Greensboro and the East Region. This one between Tennessee and West Virginia, you saw earlier here on ESPN. Tennessee, the Volunteers, just did not volunteer to bother playing in this game. They didn't show up. Ray Foster cuts to the hoop, gets the pass, and lays it in as the Mountaineers are out in front early. Daryl Prue then hits the fall-away jump shot. Mountaineers up 10 in the first half. Inbounds play, Herbie Brooks just has to grab it and lay it home. Where's the defense? Second half, Steve Berger steals the ball, then has the double clutch, hits the jump shot, falling away, nails it. Finally, Ray Foster steals the ball, goes in for the Showtime Slam. West Virginia wins handily and wins easily. 84-68 was the final. They advance in the East, being played in Greensboro, that in the first round. Herbie Brooks with 22 and Ray Foster had 19.
2 minutes and 20 seconds, excuse me, Clark.
They're going to use some clock.
And a foul on Brooklyn of Pittsburgh. So we'll go to the Ball State line now to shoot one plus one. Paul Evans, what swings of emotion he's had tonight. Started off down by 14, came back led by 7. Now trailing again by 1 as Brooklyn sits down with McCurdy at the line where he's 0-for-2. Planked, but went through.
Well, he wants the ball. I mean, he's come up with a couple of big baskets after really being cold most of the half. And now it's game on the line time, and he's coming through.
Rolled it in off the front of the rim again. He has 14 points. It's 58-55, Ball State by 3.
Let me see a pick to throw it in the shoulder. Just once. Let him touch it.
State has scored 9 straight, and there's an interception. Miller comes up with a loose ball, but sneaks a peek at the clock, which shows a minute 54. You see the clock on your screen. Kidd moves to the hoop and is fouled by Martin. That'll be 5 on Bobby Martin. Fouls out of the game with only 4 points. Martin averages 12 points a game and was held to only 4 tonight. He exits with a minute 47 to play.
He can't believe it. He's in shock. He must have thought they whistled it on somebody else.
So Martin reluctantly leaves the court as you watch what put him out of the game.
Here's a nice move by Kidd. There's a little push. Reach in by Matthews, but Martin pushed on the drive. That's an empty feeling to have to leave a tight ball game, any ball game when you foul out, but especially NCAA first round game and late in a close ball game to have to walk off and dry off.
Clark, do you think the comeback by Pitt that enabled them to come from 14 down to regain the lead and then start to draw away took a lot out of them so that they're coming up empty here at the end?
I really don't think that was the case, Tom. They did it methodically. They really only got a few transition baskets. They exerted themselves a little more at the defensive end. They pressured a little bit full court. And I really don't think that's been the problem. Ball State has come up with good, sticky defense, and Paris McCurdy has come through with some big baskets for him.
Brooklyn comes in to replace Martin as Kidd sights the free throw and connects. He has 12 points. First team All-MAC performer, former high school All-American out of Detroit, Michigan.
I tell you what, he and McCurdy can bang with just about anybody across the country. They get in there and do it.
Not the roll. 60-55, Ball State with a 5-point lead. They've now scored 11 in a row. Brooklyn hits a three-pointer. And Pittsburgh stops the clock with a timeout. Rod Brooklyn, three-point shot, makes it 60-58, Ball State leading by 2.
of the elder statesmen on this team, a junior, stepping forward here with the three-point bomb. Another angle. He shot that one like he meant it.
60-58, Ball State by two. Full court pressure from Pitt. Clock now down to a minute 25 seconds.
Pitt needs a good defensive stand here. Ball State would love to get a deuce to put it back to a two-possession situation.
Push off, Shorter's fouled out. Brian Shorter, Pitt's leading scorer and leading rebounder, has been in foul trouble the entire game, and he'll leave for good with a minute 15 left.
Now it gets interesting. Here we get a look at the foul. Oh, yeah, he had the right arm in Kidd's face.
He leaves with 13 points. To be honest, though, Clark, Pitt played better with Shorter on the sideline.
Well, they made the big run, the 20-2 spurt, when they got on top without Shorter. But certainly you're much better off with a player of his caliber on the floor.
To this point, only seven players have seen action for Pitt. The eighth will be Gilbert Johnson, who comes in to replace Brian Shorter. Johnson, number 42, and White is a 6'8 junior from Conway, South Carolina. Averages only 1 point a game. Curtis Kidd at the free throw line. He'll shoot 1+1. Ball State leads it by two. A minute 15 on the clock. Kidd just 9/10 shy of his average, and now right on it with his 14th for the night. Rick Majerus, who coached at Marquette, was 12 years an assistant at Marquette under Al McGuire and Hank Raymond.
Been a year as an assistant with the Milwaukee Bucks under Don Nelson. And you see a lot of Nelson's tendencies in terms of how they try to play defense at Ball State with the sloughing, helping man-to-man. And they do it well.
One timeout apiece remaining. Clutch free throws by Kidd put Ball State up by four. Brooken cross court. Shot on its way from Porter. Short. Fumbled out of bounds. Butts hit it last. Pitt gets another chance. And even 1 minute showing on the clock. It's been a game of spurts. Right now, Ball State with the upper hand by four. Matthews. Baseline jumper is no good. Foul on the rebound. Brooken at Pittsburgh. That's the fourth personal foul on Rod Brooken with 51 seconds remaining. It'll be Paris McCurdy at the Ball State free throw line where he's had mixed success, 2 of 4.
He stood tall though over the last couple of minutes of this game.
With the two transfers, McCurdy and Kidd are hitting the clutch free throws for the Ball State Cardinals. And McCurdy, early in the half, seemed to be intimidated inside. He regained his composure, and he's been a big factor in the Ball State comeback. 6-point lead, Ball State 64, Pittsburgh 58. Panthers need a three. Brooken got it off the glass. 64-61, Ball State, and a foul. 1+1, Jason Matthews, his third.
I know he didn't call that bank, but it counts all the same. Now it becomes a free throw shooting contest for Ball State. They've got to continue to knock down these charity tosses. Look at Brooken on this bank from dead center.
Butts at the Ball State line. No good. Stolen by McCurdy. Ball State has it back. McCurdy with a clutch steal. And now Miller is fouled by Porter.
Boy, that's a huge play by McCurdy. He's done it all for him down the stretch here.
Big three throws, big hoop, and that steal. Brooke never saw him from behind it. Never saw him.
And so Greg Miller, who's 2 for 2 at the line tonight and an 80% shooter on the season, will step to the stripe, trying to make Pitt have at least 2 possessions with 25 seconds left.
He used it all.
Rick says he had it all away.
He's been rather calm over there, other than calling some very good timeouts when things were slowly getting out of hand.
Miller has scored off the bench 13 points for Ball State. They lead it by 5. Oh, through the legs of Gilbert Johnson like a wicket. And Pittsburgh turns it over. Ball State fans start the celebration. 19 seconds left. Ball State by 5. There's the foul. Matthews, number 4, and will walk to the Ball State free throw line. Boy, have they hit the free throws down the stretch.
Playing with one another. And they really want to prove this 28-2 mark coming into tonight's game.
The NCAA Basketball Championship.
Opening night at the NCAA tournament, and there's a Cinderella named Sienna. Mark Brown makes 2 free throws with 3 seconds left, and this unheralded team from the outskirts of Albany, New York, in its first NCAA tournament game ever, knocks out third seeded Stanford, upset number 1 in the tournament. While the great escape belongs to Oklahoma, which rallied from 17 points down to nudge East Tennessee State. Expect the unexpected on the road to the Final Four. Good evening, everyone. I'm Jim Nance, along with James Brown in New York City, and we welcome you along the road to the Final Four here on CBS Sports. As Stanford and Oklahoma can attest, the road is long and tricky, and we look forward to bringing you all of the twists and turns from here to Seattle.
All right, Jimmy, and coming up in just a few moments, we'll be going out to Boise, Idaho for live opening round action in the West region.
Still plenty more to come. Right now, let's go back to Indianapolis for the final seconds.
9 seconds left in the game. Pittsburgh hitting the 3-point shot. Tom Hammond and Clark Kellogg from the Hoosier Dome for the final 9 seconds. Ball State 66, Pittsburgh 64. Pitt calling his final timeout to set up the press. McCurdy fouled by Brooken. That's the 5th foul on Rod Brooken. He is the 3rd Panther to foul out.
Oh, you hate to have him making the foul in that situation. He's knocked down a couple of 3-pointers to keep the Panthers alive here.
Clock shows 7 seconds left. Rick Majerus saw his team sprint to an early 14-point lead. Then saw Pittsburgh come back in the second half to lead by 7. And over the last 8 minutes or so, it's been seesaw back and forth. Ball State has had the upper hand, and Pitt's hanging right in there with 3-point shooting. Gilbert Johnson and Pat Cavanaugh are on the floor to replace the fouled out players. Cavanaugh, the man, a guard that just came in to replace Brooken. And here's McCurdy. One of the heroes for the Ball State Cardinals, Paris McCurdy, has now hit 5 free throws in a row after missing his first 2. And they have been clutch tosses. This one would cause 2 possessions for Pittsburgh. And he got it. Miller lets fly with a 3. No good. 2 seconds left. Cavanaugh, and the game's over. Rick Majerus, with Division I's best record, now 29-2. Hang on to
beat Pittsburgh 68-64. They'll move to the second round to face Illinois. Boy, that's a good feeling.
Oh, it's a great feeling for them. A lot of people doubted them, figured Pitt would win it easily, but these guys came out here and took care of business between the lines. Paris McCurdy, the start of game for the Cardinals, as he came up with big basket after big basket in the last 3 minutes.
And what about the courage of Pittsburgh to come back and make a game of it, despite the fact their top gun, Brian Shorter, was in foul trouble?
Ball State, their 29th win of the year. David Letterman, who went to Ball State, called up and said, hey, have Dick fight. It's not Ball State. It's Ball State. Wear the hat.
I'll tell you one thing. He should cheer at the next game. Get in there with all that cash. Get the limo. Get down there for those kids. Get on that sideline, Letterman, and do your thing, baby, for Ball State.
All right, Illinois is next for Ball State. Right now, SportsCenter is coming up. Bob Lee and Bill Patrick. So stay with us. Still plenty more to come. Five more live games tomorrow. Tim Brando will join you then.
The action, Memphis State against DePaul, coming your way after this message and a word from your local station.
Welcome everybody to the great state of Idaho. The West Region action continues with the DePaul Blue Demons of Chicago against the Memphis State Tigers. Already today, the top seed in the West, Arizona, advanced. They'll play Clemson on Saturday. A short time ago, the running Rebs of Vegas, UNLV, eliminated one of the host schools out here, and now they will meet the winner of this game also on Saturday. Good evening, everybody, and welcome. I'm Brett Musburger. We're deep into the first day, and already we have had some surprises. Billy Packer, how about the job by Rick Majerus in Ball State a short time ago against Pittsburgh?
Brent, I remember when he started his program 2 years ago, and he said to me, Bill, I'm not very good, but I've got a bunch of transfers sitting out. By next year, I'm going to be good. He's an outstanding coach, and obviously he's been right. He's got the best record in America.
And here we should have a good one tonight, a great coaching contrast. You, of course, remember the legend, Ray Meyer, now working with radio station WGN in Chicago. 5 years ago, turned the reins of the Blue Demons over to his son, Joey Meyer. And Billy, he has taken this team to the NCAA every year that he's been a coach.
Well, a very interesting situation. Not only was Joey a great player there, he also was an assistant coach under his father, and then took over one of the toughest situations of all time. And remember, 2 years ago, he was really struggling. Now it's solid. He's relaxed. He's got this program in great shape. One of the top young coaches in the business.
And down in Memphis, a great basketball city, a different kind of a coaching transition. Dana Kirk ran into difficulty. He was replaced by an assistant and a former star with the Tigers, Larry Finch, who led this team all the way to a championship in the 70s before bowing to UCLA.
Well, I don't know if we could ever have a situation quite like this. Another guy, a great star at his school, an assistant coach at his school, and now a head coach. Larry Finch, another one of the young giants in the coaching profession. I know he's very proud of what he's done with his basketball team, but I think the greatest thing about it is the way he's turned around the Memphis State attitude in great shape. These are two quality coaches, two quality teams. It should be quite a game for us to wrap things up today.
Most folks expecting a close one here today. Memphis State is the favorite, but only by 5 points. We'll meet the starting lineups in just a moment.
CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship is sponsored by the Heartbeat of America, today's Chevrolet. Metropolitan Life and affiliated companies. Get Met. It pays. And by Delta Airlines. We love to fly, and it shows.
Tim Brando back in our NCAA Today studios. A quick check now of some scores. South Alabama trailing Alabama by a score of 31-20. Michael Angeli is a blue-collar player, one of the most under-publicized, fantastic players you'll find. 6'7", he really gets it done down on the blocks, plays much larger. They have a large lead. And it could be a long, long evening for Ralph Miller. Evansville staying with Oregon State. Let's get you back to our game now. In Providence, here's Mike Gorman and Ron Perry.
13-point Iowa lead and Roy Marble at the line. He now is in double figures along with B.J. Armstrong here in the first half. Marble's got 10.
Got to give credit to Iowa. I mean, Rutgers came out and shot the ball so well early. Iowa has just stayed with their game plan, shot it extremely well, and now built up a 14-point lead. And Rutgers, you know, played pretty well in this first half.
Dattica can't hit the three. A great box out there by Iowa as the ball hit the ground. B.J. Armstrong, bullet pass. Good look by Duckett underneath, quick hands. Now back comes Carter. Right side, Dattica. He'll pull up again. Short with it. Strong rebound. Good follow, Anthony Duckett.
Oh, that's what you call staying with the play. Duckett just getting in there and rebounding. Dattica having a little trouble finding the range. Rutgers has got to get out and do that a little bit more. Try to run, but they've got a rebound to do that. Then they'll have a couple of offensive rebounding opportunities.
Four rebounds in the first 14 minutes of this game. That'll be Jepson over the back with the foul. Second foul on Les Jepson.
Les Jepson starting in favor of Ray Thompson, who was declared academically ineligible by Iowa. The freshman had a solid season. Jepson brings a lot of size to the lineup, though. Look at Jepson on the ball. 7 feet. He's got a foot height advantage over Rick Dattica.
Bullet pass comes out to Duckett and right back to Dattica. Skips it ahead for Savage. Savage again sets his feet. Long after hitting his first couple, he has missed. Hit three in a row, and now he's missed about four in a row.
Shaking his head a little bit, too. Marble.
Roy knew about halfway through that he wasn't going to like the ending of that move.
Got himself into something that he couldn't quite get out of, a 360 that just kept going.
Iowa dominating the backboards.
A number of those, two offensive boards.
Dattica again having trouble. Bounce pass this time to Carter. Dattica, to his credit, though, is going to go with a quick push to see if anything develops.
I think he should. With Jepson on the ball, he's got to try to run him.
Savage just threw it away. Careless pass. Here comes Garner. Nice dish underneath. Moses took his time and got two.
Iowa right now bearing down defensively.
Pass gets by Marble. It'll be right for his ball again. A chance to get to six. And you see it happen a lot that one player just gets so hot, the other four forget their offense.
That's right. And I mean, I think people have been watching BJ hit that jump shot, but he also handles the ball and gets it to other people. That's off Savage's leg.
Yep, just lost it on the dribble.
Got himself going with too much locomotion that time. Couldn't slow down.
14th turnover for the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers, who are down by 8 with 43 seconds to go. Garner comes back in, and one would think Tom Davis will take the last shot if he can here. Shot clock is off.
Try to hold for it. You know, you look at stats a lot, but coming into this game, Rutgers as a team had over 100 more turnovers than assists, and clearly this is the kind of game when you get into this level of play, you've got to take good care of the ball. I think with the pressure on Armstrong here and the man defense late, Marble might be the man that could free up for this last-second jump shot. Should take it with about 5 seconds to go.
Starts to move, top of the key, Marble. Little long with it, rebound McGinnis. Rutgers has got a shot here. Up ahead, good pass. Layup, won't go down. Follow does! Lee Terry.
A lot of time left on that clock. Marble took it early. Great run by Rutgers before intermission.
That's the end of the first half with the score. Iowa 45 and Rutgers 39.
So a great run by Rutgers at the stretch of the first half. You had to figure they were capable of doing it. And Carter actually came alive, and that had much to do with the run by Rutgers, that along with the play of Savage. So after BJ had all the paydays early for the Hawkeyes, Rutgers is very much back into the thick of this one. Let's quickly now, Dick, talk about what has happened thus far today. So far, no real surprises. Syracuse advancing, Michigan advancing against Xavier. They had to struggle. And NC State, surprisingly, by the margin in which they once led against South Carolina, but still no surprise that they won the game. So everything really going to form on a day when we expected the opposite, really.
I thought there was an outstanding game between Michigan and Xavier. I thought that was a tremendous basketball game. Up-tempo, a lot of great athletic moves. Certainly Rutgers right now making it exciting against Iowa. And the key right here is Raymond Thompson becomes really big for Iowa. He's out of the lineup. Academic problems at Iowa. They got him on the sideline, suspended from the team. And he could be a key player missing because they don't have a whole lot of depth off that bench, Iowa. And that could be a factor down the stretch against Rutgers.
Now, earlier today, South Carolina took on North Carolina State. George Felton, a one-time assistant under Bobby Crimmins. You know he had to be on the phone with Bobby. How do I handle that ACC opponent? Well, he didn't get the good word because Chris Corciani was too much. Wolfpack led by 16. Now, during a South Carolina 9-point run, John Hudson fires up a layup, and that didn't make Coach V too happy. At the half, NC State still with the lead. And then it was razzle-dazzle showtime. Corciani with the dish to Kelsey. The scoop to the hoop, and it counts. And the last insult, Corciani again with the steal and the lob to Weems. A disappointed look from the Gamecocks, and the ACC really rolling around now. 4-0 now in this NCAA tournament. And let's take a look at the Eastern Regional Bracket. That sets up North Carolina State against the winner of the game you're watching now, Iowa and Rutgers. And that will be an interesting game no matter who wins this one, whether it's Rutgers or Iowa. We'll come back in just a few moments. An interesting game taking place out west. We'll talk about all of the other games when we come back to the NCAA Today. ESPN's NCAA Basketball, Iowa versus Rutgers, is brought to you by your Toyota dealer. Whatever car or truck you choose, you'll love the quality. Who could ask for anything more? By new right guard sports stick from Gillette, antiperspirant and deodorant. Anything less would be uncivilized. By 7-Up, the choice for refreshment. Cool me down, 7-Up. And by Delco Electronics. From car music to onboard computers, automotive electronics, it's who we are. The march is on. The madness is here. Hello again, everyone. I am Tim Brando running a two-on-one fast break with John Saunders, who will be joining up with Dick Vitale for the nighttime portion of our NCAA first-round coverage here on ESPN. As Dick Vitale mentioned just moments ago, the best game of the day thus far, Xavier and Michigan. The Wolverines with a brand new coach, Stephen Fisher, on the sidelines for the first time, encouraging his Wolverines. And the Musketeers rally. Tyrone Hill is open inside for the tough shot over Loy Vaught. Xavier coach Peter Gillum loves what he sees, the former Digger Phelps assistant coach. Michigan adjusted, though, to Xavier's pressure. There's Terry Mills with a pass inside to Rice for the slam. He had 23. They were tied at 78. Just over 3 minutes left. Watch Michigan's hustle off the Rice miss. They keep pounding the boards. Finally, Demetrius Caleb will corral it, hit the long two-pointer, and Stephen Fisher is a winner, 92 to 87. Now, South Alabama is taking on Alabama in a meeting that a lot of people in that state have waited for a long, long time. Here's what has transpired in the first half. The Crimson Tide, 11 of its first 18 shots, and Michael Angeli rebounds his own miss, sticks it. Oh, the Rainbow Jay, nothing but net. Several possessions later, Gary Waits with a quick drive to the hoop, another underrated guard in the Southeastern Conference. He gets the roll there. Waits also dished out six first half assists. Watch him hit Angeli. The big guy sends it in. The typical Wimp Sanderson kind of player. Michael Angeli at 6'7", plays 6'11", bringing back memories of Leon Douglas. He is far shorter. Let's take a look now at the bracket in the Southeast, with Alabama apparently headed for a meeting with Michigan if things hold up. And what a game that could be. And Dick Vitale, you know, you have to stop and give Wimp Sanderson some credit. He beat Florida, the SEC regular season champion, two of their last in the last two meetings in the last 2 weeks. They're a hot club.
Well, they're playing really well right now. They got good quickness. I like their quickness, and I like the backcourt play of the kid Waits you just mentioned. Mm-hmm. He's a good penetrator, and Ansley is a kid that really does a solid job on the front court. The question mark against Michigan, do they have enough size inside? I thought Steve Fisher, who's an interim coach, I guess I'd like to have that interim tag removed. He told me today, you know, Dick, you worked 17 years to be a head coach, and I know down deep he really wants to be the head coach of Michigan. Well, it's in your hands, Steve. Win the national championship, and Bo has no choice But you look at Michigan's front court. Terry Mills, I thought, played very hard today. Something I haven't seen all year long. Terry at times plays really with some intensity, and at other times he really disappears. But Michigan was very fortunate to get that win against Xavier.
All right, so stay with us. We'll be back in just a few moments with more of the NCAA Today. Rutgers staying right with the Hawkeyes in Providence. World B. Brando, once you pass it to me, you never get it back. Welcome back to the NCAA Today. Let's quickly talk about Syracuse and Bucknell. Earlier today, Derek Coleman on the pine. He's got that injured tailbone, so his tail was on the pine. But it didn't matter. Billy Owens gets the alley-oop for the deuce. David Johnson out of Morgan City, Louisiana, with a dish to Billy Owens. And Owens with a career-high 27, 52, 36 cues at the half. Second half, Bucknell came on. Mike Joseph to Mike Butts for the slam. Bison cut it to four. But the general was hot. Stevie to Sherman from Sherman. And the general was also hot. Take a look at the three-pointer. Douglas with his 2,001st career point. First Syracuse man to do that. And the Orangemen roll over the Bison 104 to 81. Now, after the game, Jim Boeheim was asked about the difference in his Syracuse team today versus a Syracuse team with Derek Coleman.
We're both of them, and we bring Billy up high, but we're able to... You know, without Derek, our defense suffers a little bit. I think that's the one big thing is defensively. I thought the other guys played hard. I thought Herman came in. I thought Richard Manning. I thought they did a good job for us, but obviously it hurts us a little bit not having Derek, but I thought everybody else dug down and played very...
Trying to find the opening.
Roy Marble back rims it. Rebound Carter. Rutgers can get the lead. Right side, Dattica.
Will Oregon State buy some more time for Ralph Miller? Watch for Gary Payton or Eric Knox. The Beavers have the ball down by two. Pete Sullivan.
19 seconds on the shot clock, 21 seconds on the game clock. Oregon State trails by two. They have the ball against a tenacious Evansville defense. Gary Payton, the junior, bumps and misses. He's going to the free throw line with a chance to tie the contest.
Did you know that Gary Payton would be the man with the rock and the ball in his hand when he came that time? Payton that time knew he had a matchup. He's going to take the ball. He's got Schreffler. He's going to take him to the hoop, through the legs. Watch him come in, draw the foul with the body, get the shot up in the air so he can go to the line and shoot two. And now you're looking at 78-76. He needs both of them to tie.
Ralph Miller's star, Payton, 5-for-5 now, 6-for-6 from the free throw line. He has 28 points, and his teammates are watching Oregon State's all-time assist leader. He hits a pair under pressure and ties the game for the eighth time. Evansville calls timeout with 11 seconds to play to set up their last opportunity.
Now we've got an entirely different game. These two teams have gone through 39 minutes, 49 seconds, and we're tied up. Now we're going to find out who wants to stay in the NCAA tournament. Evansville's got to get the ball in. They have 11 seconds. They have more than enough time to get the ball up court, into shooting position, to get a good shot off. Look for Scott Kaffner, number three, to try to take the shot. You brought him here, you'll try to keep him here.
Let's tuck in the fact that we'd like to take the opportunity to thank NCAA Basketball Committee Representative Gary Cunningham, Tournament Manager Dick Barch, and Tournament Media Coordinator Butch Henry. From Evansville, Director of Athletics James Byers, and Basketball Coach Jim Cruz, and his staff, and Sports Information Director Bob Boxell. And from Oregon State, Director of Athletics Lynn Snyder, Head Basketball Coach Ralph Miller, and his staff, and Sports Information Director Hal Cowan. Jim Crows has his team huddled around him. You suggested that Scott Hafner is the man they want to go to. They've ridden his shoulders into the NCAA tournament. He was the MCC Player of the Year in 1989. If you're Oregon State, defensively, do you do anything special?
Well, I would look for either Knox, their best defensive player, or Brantley, their other good defensive player, to be on Hafner. Ask one person to maybe keep a second eye on. Reed Crow. Crafton, number four. He has come up today with big baskets as the game has gone on. He might be the other person to take that last shot for Evansville.
But what you're saying is you're not looking for a trap or a double team. You think Oregon State will play them head up?
No, they're going to have to play them head up because, remember now, Peyton, Knox, Alibegovic all have four fouls.
Evansville has hit a dry spell, and now they're clinging to a hope of pulling this one out with 11 seconds to play. They have to go the full 94 feet. And as you see, Oregon State is prepared to press all over the floor. Hafner to put the ball in play. And he gets it in to Mack, the freshman, right back to Hafner. He's a great free throw shooter. It won't count. We're in overtime.
He not only got one shot off, he got almost two of them off.
Great.
Wow, would that have been something if the second shot had fallen for Hafner? 78 all, Evansville and Oregon State. Remember, though, Dan Gottfried, the 6'9 player that averages 16 a game, is out. He fouled out of the game. That will hurt the Purple Aces in the overtime. Now, South Alabama is playing Alabama. It is 59-53, so the Jaguars making a bit of a run now for Ronnie Arrow against Wimp Sanderson's Crimson Tide. And Colorado State and Florida just underway. Now, believe me when I tell you, on paper coming in, this was one that you could just feel that the lower seed might have the advantage. Colorado State loves to play that disciplined game against the Florida Gators. Now, Dick Vitale, who is with me, gee whiz, I mean, you have to look at Evansville and Oregon State and say, well, Ralph Miller has been bought a little more time.
He's 70 years of age, but what a thinking man on that sideline. Great coaching strategy against Evansville. Rather than sit back with 11 seconds on the clock, he extends defensively, goes to pressure so that they can't bring the ball up quickly and get the high percentage shot. The guy is sharp as ever. Will a star be born? Jimmy Cruz? Could he be another protege of Bob Knight and become another Mike Krzyzewski?
Who knows what evil lurks within the head that belongs to Dick
Vitale. Where do you get all these lies? Evil lurks.
Stay with us. We'll be back as they end career one more game. They have a 2-point lead against Evansville and Jim Cruz.
Oregon State has built a slender lead in overtime. And the Beavers have the ball. Less than a minute and a half to play in the extra session. Gary Payton has been a big reason why. Alibegovic, a big factor in overtime with 8 points.
Alibegovic has been able to take advantage of the mismatch that he has with Bob guarding him.
Evansville's ball as Scheffler steps in and forces the turnover. So the Aces could tie with a conventional field goal here as Ralph Miller looks on, trying to stall retirement. His next loss, his last game.
A minute 15 left in the first overtime.
Hafner.
And there is the man from the MCC, Scott Hafner. Averaged 24 and a half points per game. Can fill it up like a supreme man.
6 3-pointers to date, 2 here in the pressure of the overtime. Evansville leads by a point, and Gary Payton has to scramble to get the ball back. Payton fouled by Crafton, and the ball, or by Hafner, rather, on the ball drop. Big play by a big player.
Payton strives on competition. He wants the ball when the game is on the line. He made the 2 free throws to put him into OT. Now watch him. At this point, he knows, I'm going up, I'm making it, I don't care if you hit me on the arm. Nice soft shot, and it goes in. He sees it from the floor angle, from the behind. Here he goes. Oh, there's the foul. He puts it in the vicinity. With a soft shot like that as a shooter, you just want to get it in the vicinity of the basket. But being soft, it'll take care of itself. But he didn't convert the free throw.
Hill gets the rebound off the missed free throw. Evansville trails by a point, but they have the ball, and you see the time remaining in overtime. Do you play for one here? Well, the shot clock is 35, so it's about 2 seconds under the game clock.
You have to play for the last shot. Take it down as long as possible, because you don't want Oregon State to be able to come back down and shoot the last one.
Crafton guided by Bradley. Hafner guided by Payton. That's a terrific goal. Ten seconds on the shot clock. Big three, Crafton.
Big league three-pointer.
Timeout on the floor. Reed Crafton delivers a three-pointer to give Evansville a 2-point advantage with 8 seconds remaining in the extra. procession.
Pete, when we were during the regular part of the game, I had that premonition because Crafton has been there when his team needed him today. Consequently, he let one fly from about 24 feet, and it was nothing but the bottom.
Reed Crafton defies the pressure as he launches this one from way beyond the three-point arc.
Maybe 25 feet, 26. He let that one fly from long range. Another second went off the clock, so now we're at 10 seconds. Here you see him. He's going to start jockeying around, crossover through the legs, and let it fly. And all net. Look at him. Is that a happy young man or what?
The fourth three-pointer in four attempts in overtime for Evansville. That's what's given them the two-point advantage they now enjoy.
So Reed Crafton, a little Chris Jackson between the legs and then pump it up from NBA land. He is a transfer from Florida, and now he's playing for Jim Crews at Evansville. Is it not? It's got to be Knox or Peyton again, right, for Oregon State?
I would think you get in the hands of Peyton right now. Penetration, try to drive the lane, either dump it off or take it to the goal, score or get fouled. Right now, you look at Peyton, he's got to do the job there. What I was surprised was the distance of the shot. Yeah. The kid went to Florida, never really played much, didn't get much PT, but right now he is a star on the campus in Evansville.
All right, now when you stop and take a look at this Oregon State team, so much emotion going in knowing that you're playing for a man that's career has spanned 38 years.
Well, he's a Hall of Famer. We talked about it, a survivor. Guy's been a big, big winner, and he's done it in a classy way. He's went to the NCAA at three schools. Mm-hmm. Only eight other coaches have done that or achieved that accomplishment.
All right. And, of course, those schools were Wichita State, Iowa, and Oregon State for Ralph Miller. He'd like to get one more game. Pete Solomon standing by at the McHale Center. They're making a lot of noise there now.
Just one.
McHale Center in Tucson, the scene. Ralph Miller, the Oregon State head coach, has given his team a play with 10 seconds remaining in overtime. Reed Crafton has just delivered a three-pointer to give Evansville the two-point lead they now enjoy. And the Beavers will have to go the full 94 feet against full court pressure from the Purple Aces.
Ball comes in to Brantley. There's Peyton with the ball.
And he's fires from three and misses. And there's a foul on the rebound. 2 seconds on the clock. The foul is on Oregon State.
And it's going to be Gary Payton over the back.
And that's Lamont McIntosh. Gary Payton. And there's Ralph Miller. He may be 2 seconds away from an illustrious head coaching career, the end of an illustrious head coaching career.
You can see how the Oregon State players and fans feel. They know that they're a second away.
Even the Evansville fans have great respect for Ralph Miller.
Emotion. Look at this. This poor lady here can't handle it.
Gary Payton fouls out of the contest. Alan Celestine returns to replace him.
Schreffler, if he can make the first and the second, it's over. If not, you never know.
A clutch free throw for the freshman, who now has 12 points in the ballgame. He's 1-for-2 from the free throw line, and he's given his team a three-point advantage. Two big ones. Evansville has eliminated Oregon State.
The jerseys with sleeves are the winners. 94-90, the Purple Aces get the victory over Oregon State. The career is done for Ralph Miller after 38 years, 674 wins, and 370 defeats. Never a Final Four, but again, so many more accomplishments at all of the institutions that he visited. And it was our sincere pleasure to have an opportunity to watch him coach this game. Dick, I would like to get your comments about what happened there at the end. No driving, no drawing the defense to him, not from Gary Payton there.
Tim, first of all, I just want to say health, happiness, and success to the Miller family in retirement. Just a class act. Mm-hmm. At the end there, Gary Payton's not a perimeter shooter. He went for the winner. He wanted to wrap it up, win the game. I thought the court was wide open. He's a tremendous penetrator. Yep. And I thought he was going to break the defense down, go in and get the deuce, go to another overtime. But Jim Crews, I could just hear Bobby Knight right now in the hotel screaming, "That's my boy, Jimmy."
And, of course, Jim Cruz has been rumored for a number of positions. I wouldn't be surprised at all if you find him replacing C.M. Newton, who, of course, is very close to Bob Knight as well, at Vanderbilt. South Alabama trailing Alabama, but only by four now. They've made quite a run, the Jaguars have. All that jelly and jam and peanut butter getting it done from the perimeter now for the Jaguars. And Colorado State leading Florida 25-20. We will update you on those games as well as get you back out.
Doesn't get the layup, but we'll get on the foul line. And what kind of a shooter is Green? He's 74% shooter. Both these teams, their starters especially, are good from the line. And in tournament play, that's important, and especially in this ball game now where the ball game is as close as it is.
Green converts. 4 points, Seton Hall lead.
Seton Hall has their starting lineup in the ball game. As you indicated, Southwest Missouri has a bigger lineup in there, and also Jackson is taking a rest. They'll need him back in there before too much longer.
Lewis on the bench with four fouls, and that really does hurt the Bears.
We're seeing a little zone matchup here for the first time in the ball game. I'm sure they're hopeful they can get a poor shot out of Seton Hall. Whitmer got a steal.
Jackson comes into the lane, pulls up, and can't get it to go. Underneath, Henderson, a rebound and a follow, and he'll go to the line. Big play by Hubert Henderson.
Well, there's that 6'10 size at your advantage. At over Walker, 6'10. Good penetration. Just kind of threw it up there. That's not too bad a shot, really. It's kind of like a pass, and Henderson takes the pass and puts it back in.
Henderson showing an awful lot of quickness, too. He just out-quipped Walker that time.
He converts a three-point play, and we are back to a two-point game. Green tries to drive on Lewis. Can't get the roll. Lewis playing with four fouls. Walker follows. It won't go. A third follow by Walker is up and good.
Boy, that was a heck of a move by Green, and a great follow and a stay with it by Walker.
You have an idea, Green may try to drive and draw that fifth foul on Lewis. Seton Hall again stays in their matchup zone. They've saved the zone till this particular time. Might keep them out of foul trouble as long as you have the lead and can force some perimeter shooting, although Lewis penetrated the zone last time.
Turnaround jumper, Henderson won't go. Fight for the rebound, and I think over the top was Lee Campbell.
He was, and Gaze had a pretty good position on him.
Both teams in a shooting situation now.
So it definitely could come down to a free throw shooting contest.
Gaze is a good shooter, 71%. We indicate he's 43% from three-point range and 50% overall. Averaging 13.5 for the Pirates and almost three assists per game. Good ball handler. Most foreign players are good passers, and he has that quality.
Gaze with 5 points.
That's it.
Very physical game down on the blocks right now. Traveling on Jackson. Big turnover.
So quick. Some of those little players who are that quick, it's hard to pick up that drive, but Charlie Spoonar did not complain. In fact, he nodded his head that that was the right call.
Now the clock really becoming a factor. 1:40 remaining in the game. Bolsey gets across the timeline.
That's a little quicker lineup. They're taking Ramos out. Bolsey and Walker, both 6'8. Gay, 6'7. And the two guards, Green and Morton, have gone almost all the way the second half. They have. Woodington played some the first half.
Jackson reached in, fouled Morton, that'll put him on the line. That's kind of a calculated foul, not a bad one.
Well, they're at the point, maybe they got to put some pressure. Morton, 84% shooter. You know, that's really the guy you'd like to have at the line if you're from Seton Hall.
Not the guy you want to put at the free throw line. He has 22 points. 17 in the first half.
Best free throw shooter on the squad.
No problem.
That's a big area he's improved his play this year, is his shooting.
had some trouble with a hand. In fact, the stretched ligament or in the index finger of his shooting hand has been bothering him the last couple of weeks. But he's gotten to the point where he's just had to play with it. It hasn't seemed to affect his shooting too much.
The Hall really winning the game at the free throw line. They're 9 of 10 at the free throw line, as opposed to Southwest Missouri State's 12 of 20. Morton gets them both. 6-point Seton Hall lead.
They're still staying man-to-man. You might think they'd sit back in that zone, but they're not.
The Bears are going to have to be aware of the clock. They're going to have to take good shots, and every possession, of course, is an important one. Stuckey fouled from behind. They're going to call Green for the foul. Actually, Green reached in. Bolsey was behind him, and Green will be the guilty party.
Well, that's probably important for Southwest Missouri State is to get the ball inside. They've either got to get on the foul line if they don't get the basket. Stuckey's just really tough inside. Good spins.
I'm not sure I saw a foul there.
Well, we've seen that often in this, both games of this tournament, where the ball looks like it's been hit, but it's almost automatic when you hear that slap. And really, legally, you can hit the guy's hand on the ball and it's still not a foul.
Stuckey having all kinds of problems today, both from the field and at the line. 2 out of 5 at the free throw line for Stuckey.
Well, the Bears just have not shot well either from the line or the field, and that's not been the characteristic of their ball club. So you have to give credit to Seton Hall's defense. They're a good defensive team, and that's been a fact in this ball game. If they win it, that's going to be the crucial key for them. The free throws.
Andrew Gaze with an easy layup, and that's one of the few transition baskets that we talked about.
And that was against the press.
Now the Hall seemingly has this one put away. Lewis misses a three-pointer. Bolsey has the rebound. And with 53 seconds left, this one's going to be in the bag of P.J. Carlissimo and the Seton Hall Pirates. But I tell you, they had to go out there and earn it, and they did.
I think they're good depth in the front line. They played good defense, which they had to do today. They were not effective inside. They did not dominate inside. Scouting report against Seton Hall was that you needed to play physical. You need to stay with them. And the Southwest Missouri Bears have done that. They just needed to shoot better. They could have had themselves a basketball game.
Well, they haven't lost by more than 5 points in any postseason game that they've been in the last 3 years. 2 years ago, they got the second round. They've been close and just have come up empty more often than not. And you have an idea we'll see this team again.
Oh, I'm sure you will. Now, they lose Stuckey. They lose Henderson also. But they have some. They've recruited early and they signed some good players. They go to the junior college ranks extensively. And the pair of guards they picked out of there 2 years ago have been very good for them.
Look at the Bears bench. Tough loss for them. Good win for Seton Hall. Real gut check for P.J. Carlissimo's team. And P.J. wasn't the least bit surprised that this game was as close as it has been. He really did expect it.
But just because of the way Southwest Missouri plays, you know it's going to be a close ball game.
Henderson leaves it for Stuckey underneath. Rejected by Bolsey.
Well, Bolsey's played well. We're not sure if Ramos is hurt badly, but he has not been a dominant force in this ball game. He really took two mean falls in the ball game. I think he's got 4 points, but for Seton Hall, it's been the perimeter play. It's been their two guards that have really kept in the ball game, both on the defensive end of the court and on the offensive end of the court.
Yeah, I think Morton, Green, Bolsey, as you mentioned, they event some good minutes off the bench for PJ. And again, something that we did talk about early in this broadcast, and that is the fact that the Hall is deep.
Well, they are. They're a team, I think, as I look at them and watch them play a transition game, I think a team that runs the court on them could get some trouble with their big people.
Walker with a rebound.
But they're very good defensively.
Well coached team, P.J. Carlissimo, as you see, and as you mentioned, coach of the year in the Big East for the second year in a row, and that's no small task. Some pretty good teams back there.
Well, the Big East started out with 5 teams in the NCAA tournament. They're down to 3. Seton Hall's going to uphold the prestige of that conference. Syracuse won today. I don't know about Georgetown. I haven't heard a score there, but that would be 3 teams moving on and 3 pretty good ones.
Kelby Stuckey fouls out with 5 points. Another really good news for Kelby Stuckey. He's going to graduate on time. Good student, communications major, and he'll probably come and take my job.
He's had a great career at the Southwest Missouri State. 4 years, played on 4 tournament teams. You know, he hasn't played on a losing team in 4 years. That, not a lot of players can say that.
Quality kid, he's going to do just fine. again, the Hall continues to shoot free throws very well. 7 points for Green, but he's got about five up down the stretch. Another turnover. And here's Morton ahead of the pack. Kind of a fitting climax, isn't it? Lewis jump hook. And the game is over. And oddly enough, the biggest margin of the day is the final score. It was at halftime, and it is at the end. A look at the final scoreboard shows Seton Hall 60, Southwest Missouri 51.
P.J. Carlissimo is advancing with the Seton Hall Pirates. They get the win over Southwest Missouri State. I'm John Saunders, taking in for Tim Brando, who's been here with Dick Vitale all morning and afternoon long. Well, now it's my turn to get a little bit of the punishment. But Seton Hall, your alma mater, you're happy about that, obviously. But P.J. Carlissimo's team, very, very tough. Oh, the ring.
Could I show my ring?
Is it a championship ring? I graduated.
It certainly
isn't that.
I paid for that. Hey, they had a tough time. You know, last year they took UNLV to 54-50 in terms of losing to UNLV, Southwest Missouri State. And when you looked at that tempo, you would give the edge to them against Seton Hall. I thought that Morton hit a couple of key shots, and that certainly helped. Green's a penetrator. And now they go to the next round and they get Evansville. And I think that they've been very fortunate in their draw that they haven't had the big, big name kind of people. And they're playing against people that are dangerous, but in terms of talent, they match up and they have a great chance to advance.
Still, when you come out of the Big East and you play the Georgetowns
exactly.
and the Syracuse, and then you go up against the Southwest Missouri State, and now in Evansville, there's always that chance that you might let down a little bit.
Well, I can't see letting down psychologically at tournament time, John. Any kid that doesn't lace them up, the first commandment of competition is you lace them up and thou shall come to play. It drives me crazy when I hear coaches or players say, we didn't play with any intensity. Then why play? Get out of the uniform. Stay in the locker room. My point is there's no reason why Seton Hall should not be ready to give a supreme effort like you're going to give tonight replacing Brando.
For the next 6.5 hours here. So, as Dick has just said, it will be Evansville up next for Seton Hall because they played a great one against Oregon State. Ralph Miller, his final game, but he didn't know that going in. We move on to overtime. Albigovich to Gary Payton. Back to Albigovich. Oregon State up 81-78. Then Albigovich hits the three-pointer. Oregon State up 86-83. Evansville has its own long guns. Ray Crafton hits the three-pointer. Evansville ties it up. Then Scott Hafner with another three-pointer. Evansville up 89-88. And the crowd can't stand to watch. Payton with the jumper and the foul. Missed the free throw. Oregon State up by one. Just seconds left in the game. Evansville down by one. And Crafton hits the long three. Evansville wins it 94-90. And that was it for Ralph Miller. The end of his glorious career. A loser 94-90. The final in overtime. And Scott Hafner had 26 for Evansville. So here is a look at the West in Tucson, Arizona. The teams that are already there. Evansville with a win over Oregon State. And Seton Hall a winner over Southwest Missouri State. Still to come. UTEP and LSU and Indiana and George Mason. Meanwhile, at the East in Providence, where we still have two games yet to come here on ESPN, South Carolina and NC State. The Wolfpack have struggled in the tournament the last couple of years, but Chris Corciani, so impressive. Wolfpack by 16. South Carolina puts on a bit of a run. John Hudson fires up the easy layup, and Valvano says, how does he get to the hole that easily? Then razzle-dazzle time. Corciani to Kelsey Weems, who scoops it underneath on the reverse and scores. And then the last insult, Corciani again to Weems. Watch him get up and jam it down. South Carolina beaten badly by NC State, 81-66. When this one was all over, Rodney Monroe finished with 22 points. So, also in the East in Providence, they would face the winner of Rutgers and Iowa. Iowa got a bit of a scare in this one early on. Ed Horton to Roy Marble, Iowa by 9. B.J. Armstrong then for 3. Again and again, he kept nailing them. B.J. with 6 three-pointers in the first half alone. Iowa by 6 at halftime. In the second half, Rutgers defense. Rick Dattica saves. Gets the ball ahead to Miles Dixon. Rutgers down by just 2. Dattica again. Bob Cousy-like bangs this one off the glass. Iowa goes on a 16-point run. B.J. Armstrong, though, goes inside and scores. And the Hawkeyes seal the victory. It was close. Rutgers got up about the midway point in the second half, but couldn't hang on. 87-73 was the final as B.J. Armstrong had 35 points in the game. So in the East, at Providence, the teams already there. NC State with the win over South Carolina.
Iowa gets past Rutgers. Still to come, Vanderbilt and Notre Dame and Georgetown and Princeton. Two games you will see here on ESPN. And, Dick, as we look at that draw, I remember when we talked last week, you said the East was a little bit soft. But when you look at NC State and Iowa, those are two teams that once they get past each other could match up against the Hoyas very well.
Iowa certainly has some great athletes. North Carolina State has the tremendous backcourt. Not a whole lot in the middle in terms of scoring. Lester will block some shots and rebound, and Chucky Brown can play. Rutgers, played them tough. Mm-hmm. Watch Rutgers in the future. Remember these two kids that played for Syracuse? Earl Duncan right. and Keith Hughes. They'll be in the uniform for Bobby Wentzel, and Wentzel is a winner.
Yeah, Earl Duncan, they missed him when Sherman Douglas was injured a bit this year. He might have been able to run it for Syracuse. Stay with us. Plenty more to come on the NCAA tonight. In just a moment, Tom Meese will join us with a SportsCenter update. Stay with us. Still two basketball games to come. Tonight, Creighton and Missouri. You know, it's been really a tough year for the Missouri Tigers. They started out as one of the best teams in the nation, and then on the trip to Oklahoma, Norm Stewart collapsed, and they found out he had cancer and some ulcer problems. It's been a year of adversity, and Chris Fowler has that story.
Balancing and juggling, one way University of Missouri students kill time between classes. It is an act the Missouri basketball players have had to learn the past 2 months. In the home stretch of one of the program's best seasons ever, the Tigers are trying to maintain their balance while juggling an ever-increasing number of distractions. Head coach Norm Stewart has been absent from the team for 4 weeks. He's now recovering at home from cancer surgery. Assistant Bob Sunvall was suspended by the university after a former player's mother accused him of violating several NCAA rules. And investigators from the NCAA are now gathering information for a possible investigation.
We're kind of becoming hard-knock kids, I think, a little bit. We had some adversities that kind of all came down on us at once and making a lot of news stories. But, I mean, we're trying to hang in there, rely on some of the senior leadership and, you know, roll with punches.
It's kind of hard. People don't understand. There's really a lot going on. And plus, there's high expectations for us on and off the court. But we've been doing pretty good, though, so far.
The Tigers split their last 8 regular season games with assistant Rich Daly acting as interim head coach. Stewart is not expected to return this season.
Until Coach Stewart does get back, I think it will help us as soon as they really say, hey, this coach is coach now, and we have to do exactly what he wants done.
Daly had been mainly a recruiter and a confidant to the players. Under him, the atmosphere has been looser and less disciplined than under Stewart. And the players have mixed feelings about that.
I don't know. He was so intense, and he always kept me intense all the time. And he expected the best out of us all the time, and he stayed on us a lot and really expected us to really do well. And with him not around, it's kind of hard to really be up all the time.
Hey, the ball's not always going to bounce the right way.
The absence of Sunbold has left Daly without any full-time help. The Tigers say that has hurt their pregame preparation. The possible NCAA investigation has been less of a distraction. 4 of the Tigers' top 6 men are seniors who wouldn't be affected by any future sanctions.
There is perhaps one more roadblock in the way of this Tiger team achieving its potential this year, the stigma of losing their first NCAA tournament game. It's happened 3 years in a row to UAB, Xavier, and last year to Rhode Island.
I mean, if we could just play like we're capable of playing, play together, play hard, I mean, there's theoretically no reason why we can't go past the first round, and we're going to look at it that way. Forget the path and march on.
First of all, our best goes out to Norm Stewart, who was just released from the hospital. He spent a lot of time in there, and we hope that he recovers very quickly. But Dick, you look at a team, Missouri, that's been knocked out in the first round 3 consecutive years, and now their coach isn't there. Is it the win one for the Gipper attitude?
Psychologically, it's really got to make them wonder. But you look at this basketball team. This team, John, is very strong. Had them earlier in the year. They played Syracuse so tough. And ultimately, you can see a matchup right. in this region between Syracuse and Missouri. Byron Irvin had a sensational tournament. The kid Anthony Peeler is a great athlete. Doug Smith is a guy with a world of talent from out of Detroit. Very talented basketball team. Rich Daly, it's a tough situation for him, stepping in, replacing a guy like Stewart, who is really considered to be an outstanding basketball coach.
Rich Daly went 4-4 to end the regular season, but in the tournament, the Big 8 tournament, he just rolled his way through, winning 3 in a row, including blowing out Oklahoma.
They really blew Oklahoma away, as you said. And Irvin, as I said earlier, was playing really brilliantly. The big guy in the middle, Leonard, they got a deep basketball team and a team that really can create a lot of problems. One for the Gipper, as you said earlier. You know, I think kids really, when they're playing basketball, aren't thinking about all those things. I mean, they're thinking about if they're really concentrating on the game, execution, get back defensively in transition, the high percentage shot, doing all the little things it takes to win. They are a very talented basketball team.
That the Missouri Tigers. Still to come, the Georgetown Hoyas and the Princeton Tigers. That one coming up from the East Region in Providence, Rhode Island. We'll get out there in just a moment, so stay with us. Plenty to come. ESPN's NCAA basketball, Georgetown versus Princeton, is brought to you by Dodge Cars and Trucks. On the street or off the road, it's the new spirit of Dodge. By Nike, reminds you to just do it. By new Wild and Mild ranch-flavored Frito brand corn chips, Russell Upsum, and by the insurance and financial services companies of the Kemper Group. Ask for our products by name, Kemper. Georgetown and Princeton still coming your way as we have yet two games to come here on ESPN's first round coverage. It will be from Providence, Rhode Island in the East Region. Providence, that's where John Thompson used to play. Used to play for the Friars there, but he'll be the coach of the Hoyas tonight. Then after that, Notre Dame and Vanderbilt. Yes, it is St. Patty's Day, but Digger Phelps doesn't like it. He's just 2-3 on St. Patrick's Day with the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. However, Digger Phelps, who do you like in that game? Notre Dame and Vanderbilt. That's a real close matchup.
That's a real tough one to call. I'm going to give the slight edge. I know it's St. Patrick's Day, but you know Notre Dame is 2-3 on St. Patrick's Day. I got a feeling it's going to be 2-4. I'm going to give the slight edge to Vanderbilt because of experience, because they got some three-point shooters that have been around and missed the clutch. Remember last year with Pittsburgh? They beat Pittsburgh. Hey, Princeton and Georgetown, I'll tell you what. I'm supposed to go home for the weekend. If Princeton can beat Georgetown, I am going to hitchhike to Providence, which isn't that far from here. I'm going to be their ball boy on their next game, and then I'm going to change into a Princeton cheerleading uniform. I'm going to lead all the cheers. Let's go, Tigers! Let's go, Tigers!
That should be enough never to happen. Motivate the team, but if they're going to win, they're going to have to do some of it from three-point range. And during the tournament, the NCAA has been conducting a phone poll on whether or not you like the three-point shot. Whether or not you like it where it is, whether you want it moved back to the international level, or whether you want it at the pro level. Well, here's the result. International winning in a landslide. Everyone says 19-9 is too close, Dick. Move it back.
That's the Stite special. I say I agree with the people international. Where am I going to go vote? I want to make it 46-10 because I'm voting for the international rule.
The international rule. It's too close, but it has opened up the game.
Oh, no doubt about it. It opens up passing lanes inside, but I just think it dominates the game a little bit too much, and I don't like it for that reason.
Okay, the Georgetown Hoyas are up next against the Tigers of Princeton. This one from Providence, Rhode Island. Let us join Mike Gorman for this one. The top seed against the 16th seed, and there's still two games to come.
Thanks very much, John Saunders, and welcome everyone to Providence, Rhode Island, the entire country now with a reason to root for Princeton. So we can see Dick Vitale here in a cheerleader's uniform come Sunday. But David and Goliath matchup, if there ever was one here tonight. Mike Gorman along with Ron Ferry. There is the Princeton Tiger who will hopefully engineer the miracle of miracles tonight. And Pete Carrill, one of the most respected coaches in the profession on the Princeton bench, has a great reputation of making other teams do what he wants to do as opposed to vice versa. But he is up against John Thompson and the Georgetown Hoyas. Arguably right now, forget about polls. Hard to imagine anyone playing better in the country, Ron, than this club right now.
They're on a tremendous roll, and Princeton's got to handle that pressure.
Let's meet the starting lineups. Here's Ray Bagley.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Providence Civic Center, an NCAA first-round basketball championship game. First game this evening, the Hoyas of Georgetown University take on the Tigers of Princeton University. Here are your starting lineups. Starting at forward for Princeton, a 6'8 freshman from Baltimore, Maryland, number 55, Matt Eastwick. At forward for Georgetown, a 6'7 sophomore from Glen Arden, Maryland, number 52, John Turner. And forward for Princeton, a 6'3 senior from Avon-by-the-Sea, New Jersey, number 34, Bob Straven. And forward for Georgetown. 6'4" senior from New Orleans, Louisiana. Number 21, Jaren Jackson. And center for Princeton. A 6'7" sophomore from Downers Grove, Illinois. 00, Kit Miller. And center for Georgetown, a 6'10" freshman from Chesapeake, Virginia. Number 33, Alonzo Horning. And guard for Princeton, 6'3" sophomore from Woodcliff Lake, New Jersey. Number 5, Jerry Doyle. Number 12, Wayne Bryan. And guard for Princeton, 6'2" freshman from Washington, D.C., number 22, George Lepwith. And guard for Georgetown, 6' senior from Washington, D.C., number 13, Charles Smith. Head coach at Princeton, Pete Carell. The head coach at Georgetown, John Thompson.
We are just about set to go. John Thompson and Pete Carell have met at half court and will return with the opening tip-off right after these messages.
It's like a packed-in 1-2-2 zone by Princeton. They'll try to match with shooters. Walks out inside.
Patient here after that initial pass inside by Smith and a traveling violation on Dwayne Bryant.
Good packed in, aggressive zone, pressure on the top. It's really a three-guard lineup that Pete Carril goes with. Bob Scrabus is called a forward, but he's really about 6'2".
Leftwich now will bring it up against Smith as the Hoyas extend the pressure. Leftwich, freshman guard. Mueller comes high, Morning won't come after him.
But we'll look for Princeton to use a lot of time off the shot clock each time down the floor. I would like to use about 30 to 35 seconds if they can.
Mueller again, and Morning a good five feet away. Scravis' shot is blocked by Turner and picked off by Morning. Here comes Smith. The trailer is Morning, puts it on the floor. He's stripped nicely. Leftwich got a hand in there.
Good call. Leftwich did get his hand in it. Offensively, Pete Carril bringing Kit Mueller out, forcing Alonzo Morning away from the goal. Georgetown in the man defense.
Eastwick now will take a top of the key. Turner a little more aggressive on him.
Pete Carril has always liked the back court cut. We're seeing Princeton play his flash already.
Here's Mueller, first time, takes it in, hits the hook shot.
Nice job by Kit Mueller, led the Ivy League with a 70% field goal shooting. Those kind of shots.
This were the old days. Now if Princeton got the ball back, they may keep it for 5 or 6 minutes.
That's right. Can't with the 45-second shot clock, though.
Morning has it stripped away, but it'll still be Georgetown ball. Here's a look at Pete Carril, 20-plus years on the Princeton bench. Kit Mueller is going to be called with the foul, jumping in his first on Princeton.
Clearly, Kit Mueller, Bob Scrabus, Pete Carril's top player, must avoid fouls in this ballgame.
I see a lot of smiles over on the Princeton bench, so truly they have come to enjoy this experience, no matter what it turns out to be. Smith outside, this is a three, out of bounds, Princeton ball.
Now, one thing Princeton should be doing against John Thompson's club is playing free and easy. I mean, not a lot is expected of him in this game, so they'll go out there and play loosely. The pressure's really on Georgetown.
Eastwick again looks inside for Mueller.
Just a spread offense, three guards.
Doyle cuts off Mueller's high post. Now Kit brings it outside.
This is a good strategy because Morning doesn't really want to venture out much higher than the foul line. So Mueller can really stand out there unattended until the clock works itself down.
15 right now on the shot clock.
There it is.
Backdoor cut, the beauty. To goaltend, give the bucket to Scrabus.
That's the backdoor cut, work the shot clock down, and that's been a Pete Carril trademark over the years.
4-0 Princeton.
Clearly Princeton needed to get off to that kind of start, get a couple of hoops, build the confidence level. They just packed the zone at the other end.
aggressively out on Turner there at the top of the zone. Inside, John Turner powers up two.
That's where Georgetown should be looking to get it. Morning and Turner clearly with the size advantage inside.
Mueller trying to get away, and a foul called on John Turner. Too aggressive on the defense. First on the Hoyas. John Thompson calling the press off the bench.
Really the biggest challenge for Princeton this one is to try to deal with this. John Thompson's teams have been so successful in the NCAA tournament, but this pressure has given people problems all year long. Georgetown leading the nation in field goal percentage defense, holding the opposition around 39% all year.
Scravis, good little fake down in the corner. Now he penetrates, and again a goaltend.
Gives Scravis some credit. He's getting it right to the bucket. Morning can't believe it, but that ball was clearly on its way down with a chance to go. Scravis. Oh, yeah, he takes that one out of the cylinder. Good call. Morning way up there, though.
6-0 Princeton. Excuse me, 6-2. I don't want to shortchange the Hoyas here.
Turner with the power move.
Morning down low and easy two.
Stay with their game plan, though, on this one. They'll continue to just be patient with the basketball. It's frustrating to play D each time down the court for about 35, 40 seconds.
Smith now came out on Mueller when he was top of the key.
It's like a 1-3-1 zone now the Hoyas have gone to, out of the man set. Really a better set because it leaves you less vulnerable to the backdoor cuts.
Scravis barks out the signals. 20 seconds now on the shot clock as Princeton has effectively held the ball for at least 30 seconds in each of their possessions. Shot clock at 8. Mueller kicks it back out. Shot clock at 3. Nice drive. Nice bucket. Jerry Doyle.
Some kind of scoop shot with about 3 to go on the shot clock.
Stolen down low. Leftwich again with a quick hand.
Done a nice job a couple of times. They're lulling Georgetown to sleep a little bit. And what happens is you play deep for so long, you want to rush it when you get it to the offensive end.
Third time the Hoyas have turned it over here in the first 4.5 minutes.
Yeah, that's right. If there was no shot clock, Princeton would be holding this thing for a few minutes right here.
This is going to be a very quick basketball game as it is if they're going to take 30 seconds off each possession.
They've played some teams this year in the 40s and 50s, averaging just over 50 a game scoring.
Beat South Carolina, who played here this afternoon, losing to NC State. Mueller. Doyle. Clears. Here's Bryant, the quick push the other way. Right side, Smith squares up. No. Mueller the rebound.
See, again, Georgetown gets down, and now you got the ball, and immediately you want to put it up and try to score it. It's a little frustrating because Princeton will come right back at you and be patient. Just a freshman now, Leftwich. A lot of pressure to handle the ball in this game. And Jerry Doyle, just a sophomore. 6 sophomores and 6 freshmen on this Princeton team. Scravis, the only senior.
Eastwood with 10 seconds on the shot clock. Here's Doyle again. Penetrates, leaves it for Mueller. And Morning sends the hook shot out of bounds. The Princeton will get the ball and a fresh 45 up by 4.
See, that's why Alonzo's shaking his head. He batted it out of bounds. Would have rather kept it in play.
There's a timeout on the floor with the score. Yes, it is. Princeton 8, Georgetown 4.
Was scored with about 5 seconds left on the shot clock. And that's a long time to play defense. And I was just surprised at how easily Princeton got the ball up court without turning it over.
All right, Matt Lappin will start the second half for Pete Carrillo's club. Jerry Doyle back in, playing with 3 personal fouls. Jaron Jackson awaits him.
This has been a key move by Pete Carrillo, bringing out Kip Mueller. He's Princeton's center, but he's able to handle the ball well. He doesn't get a lot of pressure when he's way out from the basket, although Morning creeping out as the game goes along.
With Doyle coming around, and he'll take the shot clock down again. Back door, Doyle gets it!
two.
That's that spread offense once again, and Pete Carril will get cutters coming from all different angles that time. Doyle from the top.
Largest lead of the night. It's a double-figure lead for Princeton. That'll be Matt Lappin over the top, I think, with the foul. On Lappin now his third, so he and Doyle play with three.
Spread floor situation again. First possession for Princeton of this second half, and it's a great bounce pass by Lappin to Doyle. Off before Morning can get it.
Bryant in low. Morning to turn around. No, the tap. No, got it back. Put it in.
I mean, you talk about Morning getting it down in the blocks, and there's just no one going to stop him down there tonight.
Scrabis and Leftwich combine in the backcourt. In the middle, it ends up in Mueller's hands again.
Princeton getting all those backcourt layup cuts actually have the advantage, scoring in the 3 second lane in this one.
Leftwich will pull it out, 25 on the shot clock.
Just a balanced offense. 1-2-2 setup.
Lappin in a little trouble, gets it back. Misses the three, rebound Winston. Took it with about 8 seconds on the clock, and Jerry Doyle just picked up foul number four.
Now we'll see. Troy Hottenstein in his place, I'm quite sure. He's getting ready to check in. Pete Carril not happy with Kit Mueller's shot the last time from three-point land. Heck, there was about 10 seconds on the clock. Usually don't take it till there's about three or four.
Pete not very happy with Jerry Doyle's foul either.
Not at all. But Charles Smith has just got to look to take charge more here in the second half. Look more for his offense, but he won't force it.
Jaren Jackson underneath. That's two. Morning lost it on the way up.
That'll be a foul on the floor, too, by Leftwich.
Yep.
Heads up.
Leftwich's second personal foul.
Somehow Morning loses control of this. He's got people actually walking away. Mueller just says, okay, he's got that one. And the foul on the floor by Leftwich.
Underneath Jackson, no, but a foul is called on Scrabis, I believe.
Right now what Georgetown's trying to do is they're just trying to get the ball into the trenches where they can overwhelm Princeton, and they're forcing some early fouls here.
2 minutes gone here, second half. John Thompson signaling the defense, I believe. He wants his butt to get in after these free throws by Jaren Jackson. Georgetown not helping themselves much here.
No, and again, this is an area where Georgetown has struggled from the foul line, a 65% free throw shooting team.
Point for Jackson.
Soft pressure by Jordan Earle. Georgetown with one, and the possession arrow favors Princeton. Well, if Princeton gets in a jam, now's the time to use up a timeout. Man-to-man pressure by the Hoyas.
Leftwich pulls it back out. Mueller. Scrabis goes on the backdoor cut.
Warning off him now, saying, hey, time to just get back into the paint area.
We're burning up in the layups.
That's right.
Mueller kicks it out. 8 on the shot clock. Back to Mueller. Cut to Doyle. Get it.
Great dish off by Mueller. Doyle with the big finish off another backdoor.
Smith. Top of the key to Winston.
Under 2 to go now.
Inside Morning, and Mueller the foul before the shot. Kit Mueller, along with his 9 points and bloody lip, also has 8 assists on the night.
What a gutty effort by the big guy. Big in a relative sense. He's about 6'7". Another beautiful feed. Doyle with a nice roll.
Watch the Princeton bench.
They're not into it too much right now. On their feet.
Alonzo Morning back at the free throw line. His club down 2.
Drilled 2 moments ago. By the freshman.
19 for Morning. 3 of 3 on the night. I had a feeling last
going that way.
A stunned Hoya bench.
That's a big look of concern as this thing winds down. Princeton by one.
Morning responds to the challenge. 49 apiece.
Look for a good 35 seconds here by the Tigers.
The fifth time this game has been tied here in the second half.
Scravis and Mueller should be handling a lot late here.
Lappin comes high. Mueller, excellent at always releasing himself to the ball. Skip pass, picked off. Morning's got it. 1 minute, 2 seconds to go. Hoya ball in a tie game.
Princeton will still get another possession. About a 20-second differential between the game clock and the shot clock.
Georgetown's going to pull it out.
Charles Smith time. And they'll try to set up Morning if they can. Mueller doing everything he can down there to front Alonzo Morning.
Mark Tillman catches and fires. Rebound Morning, lost it. Tillman got it. Won't go down. Kept alive three times, four times. Morning.
Foul from behind by Scravis.
And Alonzo will return to the free throw line.
I think he got him on the floor. Morning with the height advantage. He was all over that offensive rebound, tipping it several times before he could gain possession. Tillman can't get it to go. And Morning, hands all over the place. Scravis kicks that one free. Morning again with the rebound after several tips. And Scravis hacking right there.
Guarded on the fourth tip to himself.
1-on-1, it was on the floor.
Yep, good call, Ron. So Morning needs to make the first.
And with 23 seconds left, depending on what happens here, stage is set for Princeton to hold for the last one.
And take a three.
And go for the win. Depending on what Morning can do from the line. Oh, he's been tough.
He's been huge at the line.
Five in a row down the stretch. With not a lot of people cheering for him. Blocking that out, and his concentration efforts are great down the end.
Biggest free throws of his young life. Missed it. Rebound, Scravis. Princeton the ball, down one. Here they come.
They may use a timeout here. They've got two left, and they do. What a ball game.
That NCAA tournament fact that was just up there.
Georgetown sends Princeton into the 1-on-1 bonus situation. The possession arrow favors Princeton, so if there's a tie-up, it stays their way. Key thing right now for Princeton is number one, just to get the ball in bounds. I look for Georgetown to put pressure on the basketball, getting it in. And then the key thing, I think, is to get the ball somehow in the foul line area to Mueller, work the cuts, and try to get the ball to Scravis if possible.
Look at John Thompson, who's over there to set his defense now with his club. And the sellout crowd here at Providence, Rhode Island, has been treated to a game that will be talked about for a long time.
That's for sure. I mean, the expectation level, clearly, no one, I don't think, was predicting this beforehand. And Princeton has just gone out and controlled tempo, kept this score, and put themselves in that position we talked about early, where they could have a chance to win, and that's exactly what they've got right now by running their game plan and backdoor cuts in this one.
And no matter what the results here in the next 15 seconds or so, the Ivy League walks out of this building tonight with their heads held very high.
No question about it.
Princeton, the last Ivy League team to win a game in the NCAAs. And they get a standing ovation from this crowd as they come back on the floor.
Key thing for Princeton now, John Thompson will have his defense set up here, stressing no fouls, stressing boxing out and rebounding, and Princeton's got to take good care of the basketball and be aggressive with it.
All right, here we go. 15 seconds. Georgetown by one, 50-49. Lappin, Leftwich, Doyle, Scrabus, and Mueller.
Georgetown man-to-man.
They give it to Scrabus. Bobby Winston on him. He gets a screen from Mueller. Comes up, fired, blocked by Mourning. Loose on the floor. Jefferson can't save it. Out of bounds.
On the floor with a second
to go. 1 second on the clock. And Princeton's got a final prayer.
Oh, Mourning has come up huge at the end of this ball game from the foul line. And with that defensive play, it's enough time for Princeton, though, to get it in and get a shot off.
The sixth block.
He's going to try to get it to Scrabus.
Lappin. Mueller fires. No. The Hoyas escape. And I mean escape. In advance to the second round in the Eastern Regionals.
Unbelievable.
The Princeton Tigers putting on just a fantastic show here tonight. They were a 20-point plus underdog coming in here, but Pete Carril's club just played their hearts out.
They believed they could do it. They came out, got the early lead, and just executed this whole ball game. Controlled the pace. And Princeton's got to be proud of their efforts. Georgetown had themselves some scare.
Princeton may have lost this game on the scoreboard, but that's the only place they lost it. 50-49, the final score. Go back to John Saunders. It's over here, John.
John, I can't believe it. Can't believe it.
Even with incredible. The Georgetown Hoyas winning by one, it has to be one of the most incredible basketball games ever played in the history of the NCAA tournament. A number one seed had never lost to a number 16 seed, and the Princeton Tigers nearly pulled it off. Dick Vitale.
I can't believe it.
You got the P on backwards. But you don't have to wear the cheerleading outfit. What a game.
Hey, I couldn't go to Providence, but I would have had to go. I can't believe this. That would have been the greatest upset in the history of the NCAA tournament. I mean, you talk about being out personnel. Pete Carril has to go down as one of the great, great coaches. And what a great effort. And we were dying here, and all the people out here are dying. There's Lauren Matthews, Jim Marchione, the NCAA. Nobody can believe it. Did they win or lose?
I think they won by one. I'm not really sure. I know you don't have to go to Providence, but we're going to go out there through the magic of television right now. John Thompson is standing by one of the most miraculous games you'll ever see. John at Providence barely escaping by the skin of his teeth. He awaits the winner of Notre Dame and Vanderbilt. Let's go back out to Providence in the Civic Center.
Well, they say NCAA time, John, is March Madness. And this was certainly some test by Princeton. They came out and really forced the Hoyas to play with a lot of boys to pull out the win. And your freshman came up huge at the end of the game, Alonzo.
Well, I thought he did, too. And I think this is a game that it's an understatement to say that Princeton deserved to win this game, because they did deserve to win it. They controlled the tempo. They spread us. We had to make substitutes because we got behind. The very thing happened that we did not want to happen. We got behind and played chase. And anybody in this country knows that when you chase Princeton, you're in trouble.
That's exactly what we were talking about. Early, they get the lead. They build up some confidence. Then they spread the floor. And each time down floor, you know they're going to run it for about 35 seconds.
Well, they spread it very wide. They got some back doors. They got a lot of things. But, you know, I tell you, I'm proud of our kids because of the fact that they didn't die and they kept playing hard. But I think we're very fortunate to win the ball game. Princeton's kids deserve to win this game.
Well, you came out with the win, and that's the important thing now. And Alonzo Mourning, he really came of age.
Well, I thought so, too. And we were debating, because they were spreading the floor, whether to take him out. And I mentioned to one of the assistant coaches, I think I'll leave him in because he'll make the big block, and that's what he did.
Good decision to keep him there. Best of luck in the next one.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. John Thompson, back to you, John.
Okay, thanks a lot. Obviously, Dick, the phrase moral victory is overused a lot. But the Princeton Tigers certainly leave Providence with their heads very, very high.
Well, Pete Carril, an amazing job of coaching. Back in 1976, when they played against Rutgers, that was the great team with Sellers and Dabney. They were undefeated, played up at Providence also, and it got down to a 1-on-1, and a kid from Princeton missed it. But Princeton, for years, has done things like this against people. But he always had better talent. One year he had Brian Taylor. Another year he had a guy by the name of Teddy Menakis. He had better talent than he possessed now.
But what an effort. I'll tell you what, that has got to be the biggest shock in that they played them that close. I guess that was just as... I'm speechless, Johnny. You know me, I can't believe this.
You know, all those kids that played for Princeton, every one of them walk out of the building and will be telling their grandchildren about the time that they nearly knocked off the Mighty Hoyas.
And that they had Alonzo Mourning begging and pleading for the rock. And that, gee whiz, can you imagine a foul call at the end? The kid has the rock in his hand to shoot to. I just can't believe it. But, John, it's just college basketball again, and that's why Sparky Anderson, Tom Lasorda, all you guys, eat your heart out. The greatest event of all time is the NCAA College Basketball Tournament. Unpredictability, one-time Russian roulette. No 4 out of 7, baby, where the top team always is on top. College basketball, one time. It's amazing.
Charles Smith won about 30 minutes before he finally did score in the game. Our hats are off here at ESPN to Princeton and Pete Carril. What a job the Tigers did. But the Hoyas advanced against the winner of our next game. Stay with us. Michigan. Michigan playing without Bill Frieder because he is at Arizona State University. Gone. So his assistant, Steve Fisher, encouraging the Wolverines. Tyrone Hill, though, open inside. Tough shot over Loy Vaught. Xavier coach Pete Gillen says score it. Xavier up by 4 early. Ramil Robinson makes the steal. Heads of court. Nobody with him, so he says, hey, I'll do it myself. Jam time. He had 23, tied at 31. Xavier keeps the heat on. Stanley Kimbrough with the nifty drive through the Michigan D. Just before halftime, Xavier up by 3. But then Derek Strong muscles up and gets the foul. He had 18, leading the Musketeers. Michigan adjusted to Xavier's pressure. Watch the passing. Hughes to Terry Mills to Rice, wide open. 23 for Rice. It's tied at 78. Just over 3 minutes left. Michigan hustle. Rice with the miss. They keep pounding the board. Demetrius Caleb finally comes up with it just inside the three-point line. He lets it fly, and Michigan gets the win for Steve Fisher. 92-87 was the final victory there. Glenn Rice and Ramil Robinson had 23 points apiece. Here's the Southeast brackets and those who have advanced. South Alabama will face the Michigan Wolverines. And North Carolina awaits the winner of UCLA and Iowa State. That game is coming up in just a moment. Dick, you look at the South Alabama game against Michigan. A lot of people would have thought Alabama would have given Michigan a tougher game. What about South Alabama?
Alabama has some great quickness, but South Alabama has also got a tremendous backcourt. Their backcourt is outstanding. We've talked about it and documented it. The two little guys back there, Hodge and also Lewis. They got the big guy inside, too. I like him. The guy from Venezuela, Estaba, he's unbelievable. I said earlier, he's the greatest Venezuelan since the guy, the great architect. I'm forgetting his name. Bolivar. Simon Bolivar. See, I know my history now.
You know a lot about a lot of things.
I'm going to go down to Princeton, maybe teach one of their courses down
there. You know a lot about a lot of things, but I'm going to keep reminding you about the Georgetown score. That might not be one of them.
Hey, John, let me just say this. Princeton, that was their biggest day since Brooke Shields entered that campus.
You've been waiting to use that one. I know. You were glad that they got that one. The Midwest being played in Dallas, Texas. Creighton and Missouri. This game is underway right now. It just ended the first half. Let's go there for the final few seconds with the call. Frank Fallon and Bob Ortegal.
So there are 5 seconds left in the half, Bob, and they just simply never knew that that shot clock was about to go off.
They played so well up to the last couple minutes of the first half, but then when Coach Peroni wanted them to slow down a little bit, it sort of broke their concentration. They didn't get a shot right there.
Who's going to take it? Doug Smith from 27 feet. He got it! Doug Smith, a 27-footer at the buzzer. What a lift for the Missouri Tigers. Cut it down to 2 on a 27-foot jump shot by a 6'10 forward, Doug Smith. That's the end of the first half with the score. The Creighton Blue Jays 39, the Missouri Tigers 37.
Chad Gallagher with 16 points in the first half. Creighton leads by 2 over Missouri, 41-39 is that score in the second half. Now also at Dallas, Florida and Colorado State. Florida trying to wave the banner for the SEC because they have struggled thus far. Florida, well, they wouldn't wave it much better than this alligator would. Joel Triplehorn buries the three-pointer from the top of the key, rams up early. But the Gators try to keep it close. Dwayne Davis, back from last week's injury, gets it for the jam. Gators within 6. Start of the second half. Dwayne Shinsis steps into the backcourt. Can't go over and back like that. Colorado State, Trent Shippen, three-pointer, rams up by 12. The Gator bench can't believe what they're seeing. The final nail in the coffin, ball stolen by Tryon. He misses the shot, but gets the rebound, takes it in. Rams cruise for the victory. 68-46 was the final score. Florida, the third consecutive Southeastern Conference team to lose the game, as Triplehorn had 20 points in this one. You wanted to talk about Creighton and the team. They will be facing Colorado State.
Well, the amazing job that Tony Baroni's done all year. When you talk about the Missouri Valley Conference, everybody talked preseason, Wichita State, Wichita State. Tony Baroni, put this down, John. I don't know where he's going to be next year, but he will not be back at Creighton. He is now a hot member of the hit list. People want him. There are a bunch of alumni I know down there, for example, at Marquette. Would love to see him on a sideline at Marquette. Tony Baroni has always been a winner. He was with Dick Versace at Bradley. He's got some Duke background in him. I'll tell you one thing. The guy's from Chicago. He knows how to recruit, knows how to motivate, knows how to coach, knows how to win. And please, Creighton people, don't call me up about this. I'm just reporting a fact.
And Tony Baroni is also one of the best names in all of college
basketball.
I like the name.
It's an A-E-I-O-U, one of my paisans.
All right, let's get back to the Midwest. Syracuse and Bucknell, because Bucknell and Syracuse, the winner of this game, would go up against Colorado State. This in the Midwest of Dallas. Syracuse playing without Derek Coleman, injured tailbone. Billy Owens takes control. Alley-oop gets the tool. Then David Johnson to Billy Owens. Jams it down. Owens with a career-high 27 points. It was 52-36 Syracuse. Mike Joseph finds Mike Butts, who with one hand puts it on. The Bison cut the lead to four, but the General is hot. Stephen Thompson, this you cannot do. And the General was hot for three-pointers, three in a row. 19 points in the day. Douglas over 2,000 points on his career. And the Syracuse Tomato was dancing. 104-81 was the final. As Billy Owens, the freshman, takes control, has 27 points. That a career high, and he does it with Derek Coleman sitting on the bench with a sore tailbone. He injured that against Georgetown. So, in the Midwest, these games being played in Dallas, Texas. Colorado State and Syracuse. Colorado State knocking off Florida. Syracuse beating Bucknell. Still to come, Georgia Tech and Texas and Missouri and Creighton. Three consecutive games, over 100 points, but boy, have they come back. They're the champions in the Big Ten, and Chris Fowler has their comeback story.
Two on one. Spin. Oh, what a pass!
Oh, showtime! Well, his team will do well against people that don't have the great athletes and the quickness. As I said earlier, they're at best right now, labeled by many people, to finish fifth or sixth in the Big Ten.
And then, on December 3rd, the Hoosiers were totally outplayed and humiliated by Louisville. Third time in four games, Bob Knight's team had surrendered more than 100 points.
We started off so bad. We get in the NIT and in the preseason and just get beat pretty badly by two pretty good teams. But we were a young team at that time. I didn't get back until November 1st, and we got a bunch of guys playing that had never really played major college basketball before. So we were a team that was young, and Coach was real patient with us.
I was trained to start us out with a really strong defensive base, make us the best, quickest, toughest defensive team we could play against. And I think that team could have been pretty good defensively, except it ended up being a very poor ball handling team. And we never really got our defense into play, and we didn't get the ball in position to do anything with it except throw it away.
But then things changed. Knight went to a three-guard offense, and Indiana caught fire.
I think it's really been a good thing for us as a three-guard front because, it may create a mismatch for some teams for us to defend, but it also creates a mismatch for them because they've got to be able to take our three guards and cover them the whole court.
It's really important in ball handling and taking away mistakes. We made a lot of mistakes early, and that helped a lot in our movement and our offense.
I think we just start playing a little harder, you know. We got the definite lineup in. This is our start. And we got things rolling.
Seven consecutive wins over non-conference opponents and the destruction of the Big Ten. All this with a team nobody considered a contender.
When I've seen people say that we're not a very talented team, that depends on what your vision of talent is. We're not a particularly big team. And we're not a real good jumping team, but we handle the ball well.
The surprising success of Indiana's football team combined with some pretty low preseason expectations in basketball created a pessimistic attitude among the student body here at Indiana. But now they're all believers.
It's been fantastic. I mean, to see a team, I mean, you got a freshman, you got, you know, Todd Jadlow at center and one solid player. It's been incredible to watch what they can do. I think this is by far Knight's best coaching year.
I don't think that coaching is always reflected in wins and losses. I think there are guys that do great jobs getting the team to 500. I think there are guys that do great jobs getting some teams competitive to play against teams that might be far superior in terms of natural talent.
The Indiana Hoosiers have come back, and they have the lead right now facing George Mason. They're up 9-3. For a peek at that game, let's go to the West Region in Tucson. Barry Tompkins and Bruce Larson standing by. The Indiana Hoosiers trying to advance against George Mason.
Hoosiers out of the block quickly. They lead it by six. Broadnax misses a jumper, and we've got another foul. And George Mason quickly getting itself in foul trouble here.
Well, they've been going to the offensive board very well, but there's some big people they have to get over the top of. Anderson and Jadlow at 6'9 each, and one 230 and the other 215. Nice basketball bodies.
And again, we'll watch how they screen. Perfect screen right there. Jadlow for Hillman. Underneath, what a pass. Edwards to Jadlow for two. Textbook stuff.
Oh, boy. And I think that's the thing that people don't really appreciate, Jay Edwards. He can pass the basketball.
Anderson comes away with a Jadlow with a quick four. Lyndon Jones runs that one down. Tries to get it into Anderson. Reach in foul on McNamara.
Well, Arizona fans can appreciate Jay Edwards because they've been watching a guy by the name of Sean Elliott do the same kind of things. He's 4 inches taller. Good power move. Jadlow's been in the program 5 years, as have five Indiana players, so they're experienced, although not a lot of playing time. They practice every day, and they know what needs to be done.
Going to call a block foul on Smith. Looked like Edwards might have gotten a shoulder into Smith going across the paint that time.
Well, he did, and Edwards has got a nice pair of shoulders on him and can penetrate a little bit and use that muscle. And, of course, in the Big Ten, they play very physical.
Ernie Nestor, you saw with that incredulous look, and why not? His team has just picked up its seventh team foul, so it's going from bad to worse for George Mason. Indiana leads it by 8, 11-3, and they will be at the free throw line for every foul from here on out, and we have only played 3 minutes and 40 seconds. That's a long road for George Mason.
You're right, Barry, and in fighting through all those screens, we might see some zone from George Mason. They do play a 1-2-2.
Edwards is short, and that will not happen very much. He's a 90% free throw shooter.
In fact, last year he shot 90. Not quite as good this year.
Hargett outside with a jumper, nails a three, and the Patriots sorely needed that.
Well, they do, and they feel, coaching staff felt, that's the key right there. He has to hit some of those, and then on the defensive end or offensive end of the court, he has to keep them turning it over.
Hillman got the baseline. He just gave it to him. He said, thank you very much.
Well, they didn't really know whether to switch or they got it mixed up on their defensive assignment. All those screens.
George Mason has been in the tourney 15 times before and won 14 first-round games. Let's go to the Midwest, Creighton, Missouri, to Frank Fallon and Bob Ortega.
Well, with 12 minutes and 52 seconds to play, the Missouri Tigers lead Creighton 59-52. Creighton led almost all throughout the entire first half, had a 39-37 advantage at halftime, but Doug Smith, the big 6'10 forward, exploded with a 25-foot jump shot at the buzzer just before the end of the first half, and has added four more baskets here in the second half, and Missouri's grabbed a 59-52 lead. My name is Frank Fallon. My broadcast partner tonight is Bob Ortega.
They'd like to get it inside to Gallagher, Creighton would, but Leonard continues to do an excellent defensive job on Gallagher inside, and he's played well, Gallagher has, to this point in the game.
Creighton now needs a basket. They've led by as many as 4 points during this ball game, but right now they're down by 7 with 12:25 to play. And Eisner, the guy with the ball right now, has 4 fouls. He hit 3 three-pointers and has kept Creighton in the ball game. Roggenberg, Eisner passed to Gallagher, threw it away. Gallagher's been pretty well closed out. He had 16 points in the first half, has managed only 2 baskets, as you look at Tony Barone, the coach of the Creighton Blue Jays.
He's done a great job at Creighton. He really has. They had a good season. They won the Missouri Valley Conference. They won the postseason tournament, played at Wichita. He works hard, and he's got a young ball club, 3 sophomores. You look at the turnover situation.
Boy,
Frank,
not many in this ballgame. 7 against Creighton, 6 against Missouri. At the pace this ball game's been played, 13 turnovers is very acceptable.
The Blue Jays continue to play that matchup zone.
This is Sanbody. Doug Smith, let's see. Won't go, rebounded by Farr. And again, Creighton has a chance to cut it down to a 5 or a 4-point lead. They feed it to Gallagher, who misses the layup. And Harstad gets it back, puts it up over the 7-footer, can't get it. So Creighton had a golden opportunity and couldn't cash in. Byron Irving carries it behind his back, tipped in by Smith, no basket. No basket Offensive goaltending on Smith.
That's a good call. That's basket interference. You cannot touch it when it's in the cylinder. You see it laying up here. Once that ball is up above that rim, you cannot go up and touch it. It's up on the rim.
59-52. Missouri by seven. Eisner playing with four fouls. DeMoser to Farr. Farr over, and a good two-point shot. Farr with a good one, hitting that one over Lee Coward.
It's a great job of moving with the dribble and stopping on a dime and getting the shot.
It's 59-50.
Missouri leading that game by five. And, Dick, I have to make a correction. George Mason has won 14 of their last 15 games overall. First time they've been in the tournament. But they're up against Bob Knight, a guy you think is the coach of the year. Now, I happen to think with Jay Edwards and Lyndon Jones and Anderson, who are all Mr.
Keep
Basketball
going on.
In their state. Hold on.
Keep
you
going
got three
on.
Guys in your starting lineup who are Mr. Basketball in their states. I'm not saying Bobby Knight hasn't done a great coaching job this year. Anytime you win the Big Ten, I don't care who you are, you've done a great job. But coach of the year, come on.
Coach of the year, without a doubt, not even close for what he did to make an adjustment to get their team in a winner's circle. You mentioned Jay Edwards and Lyndon Jones. They're both sophomores. You mentioned Eric Anderson. He's a freshman. And then you start talking. Todd Jadlow, and the beat goes on and on. Lute Olson's done a great job too, John. And certainly, I based it on what the regular season, who knows what the postseason. You know what's interesting, though? Let's go to that Colonial Athletic Association. Amazing. I'm surprised Richmond didn't get into the NCAA tournament, because remember their success last year? They beat Indiana. They beat Georgia Tech. They would have had one loss this year in their league. But also that league had a lot of success when they had a guy, the Admiral, the captain. You know who I'm talking about.
David
Robinson. When he came in with Navy. Tom Yeager and the people in that conference have to be mighty proud. And I'll tell you something else. George Mason's got a kid that can flat out play. His name is Kenny Sanders. And Pete Carell, can't forget him. The highest compliment I could pay a coach, baby. He can flat out coach.
You mentioned Richmond. They blew away Temple in a rematch of the Sweet 16. That in the NIT. And a lot of the people at Richmond feel they definitely belong in the tournament. But George Mason is there to represent.
UCLA 76, Iowa State 68. We're inside the last minute, 32 of this ballgame. Iowa State trying to keep the run up. They get it up there, and it's there. Terry Woods comes through with number nine. A little goaltending because somebody had their hand up through the bottom of the net, Dan. Jim Herrick of UCLA, first year out there.
And UCLA, of course, knows they're going to be pressed. Iowa State in a desperate situation right there. There's Johnny Orr. He's got to be disappointed because he did get great inside scoring from Victor Alexander, but his club really turned the ball over a lot. And they really, they caught UCLA in the second half, but just couldn't take command of this game. The Bruins have done a nice job of making the big shot. Now, they have not shot their free throws very well. They finally get one down. They're coming off three misses in a row.
That's 7 points for Derek Martin. 10 out of 17 from the free throw line for UCLA. But they are 33 of 58 from the field for 57%. Very few times tonight have they hit two in a row, but Martin does it when it counts. 78-70. Iowa State's got to have a three-pointer or so.
Yeah, there's the long jumper by Terry Woods. And I really think the defensive job by Derek Martin, number 15, has negated Woods, number four, for Iowa State. And that's one of the reasons that Bruins are in the league, because Iowa State has just dominated UCLA on the offensive boards, and they've been able to get a lot of second and third shots.
But I think the big reason that they are ahead right now is they finally started getting some defensive rebounds. They were being out-rebounded so badly early in this half that the Iowa State came in and took the lead away from them. 80-70, they're back by 10. A try for three. And again, UCLA comes up with a defensive rebound. That is now 25 defensive rebounds for them. This is Wilson, tapped up and in by McLean. That's 23 points for Don McLean.
UCLA right in the rhythm right now. Of course, Iowa State's not a three-point shooting team. There's Bourne all the way in for an easy score. The Bruins going to let him go. Timeout, Cyclones, just to stop it. Might be their last timeout.
It was indeed their last one. Timeout of the floor. UCLA leads only 25 seconds to go. UCLA is 17-0 when they have held their opponents to 80 points or less in the ballgame. UCLA will now go, if they hold on for 25 seconds, barring any miracle by Iowa State, at 18-2 when they have led at the halftime. The foul very quickly for Iowa State. It's going to be on Hughes Suffren. 6'3", senior out of Kansas City, Kansas. So Johnny Orr, 141, 125 in 9 years, and 24 years of coaching after he left the North College in Wisconsin in 1949.
He's won 389 and about to lose his 271st game.
But I really think he's got to be happy with the way his team performed. It's an overachieving type of ball club. Wasn't really expected to be here in the NCAA tournament. And I don't think these guys right here have anything to be ashamed of. They played very hard and very well. UCLA just shot the ball extremely well from the outside. And I thought their press hurt Iowa State. When they went into that 2-2-1 full court, they got two or three steals in a row, and the Cyclones just weren't, they were not able to solve the press.
There's a shot underneath and up by Jay Goodman. He has two. 5 seconds is all that remains. Richardson with it. Behind the back pass, Goodman has it, and that ends the games. Iowa State will go back to Ames, Iowa, with a score of 17-12 on the year as they finish up the 1988-89 season. UCLA wins to 20.
So the UCLA Bruins have advanced. They will play yet another day. However, Iowa State is done. Now, let us take a look at the Southeast bracket and see who has advanced. UCLA with the 84-74 win will face North Carolina. Michigan against South Alabama. Now, in the West, George Mason and Indiana. This one just finished up just a while ago, and the Indiana Hoosiers have come away with the victory. 99-85 is the final, as Bobby Knight's crew has gone with another victory. So, in the West region, not only Bobby Knight has advanced, but there's a host of others going on. The four teams yesterday and four today. Evansville will face Seton Hall. Evansville over Oregon State. Seton Hall beats Southwest Missouri State. UTEP and LSU still to come, and Indiana is in there. In the Midwest, the Midwest region, the team's advancing there, and we saw some of it here tonight on ESPN. Missouri, the Tigers are in with the win over Creighton. Georgia Tech and Texas still playing. Texas has the lead there. Colorado State will face Syracuse. Those games being played at Dallas, Texas. Those teams advancing, with, of course, with the teams who advanced yesterday. And in the East, Georgetown by just one over Princeton, 50-49 was the final. They'll face Notre Dame. They beat Vanderbilt easily. And NC State over South Carolina. Iowa beats Rutgers. So those two teams will meet in the next round in games being played in Providence, Rhode Island. Dick Vitale, this is St. Patrick's Day. And I heard Mike Patrick say that you like these bagels. And this is a green bagel, ladies and gentlemen. So what else for St. Patrick's Day? Enjoy.
Well, thanks a lot, John. It's been a pleasure working with you and Timmy. Had a great time. I'm a little surreal right now. Help me out.
Surreal. We are not done here. Although we are done here tonight, SportsCenter is coming up in just a moment with Bob Lee and Bill Patrick. A reminder, there's still plenty to come here on Monday. The NAIA Championship game. You can see it here at 9:30 Eastern Time. And before that, it will be Penn State and Villanova. That at 7:30 in the NIT, the second round play. So thank you very much once again for joining us here for Tim Brando and Dick Vitale. Enjoy SportsCenter. It is coming up next. And 32 teams are done. There are still 32 teams still in the hunt for that outstanding one clear moment.
I see you looking around, searching for some good times, girl. Ain't no doubt about it.
The greatest upset in college basketball history. Princeton and Georgetown. A passionate chess match played in Providence.
CBS Sports, the NCAA Basketball Championship.
It is night number two in the NCAA tournament, and top-seeded Georgetown gets physical with pesky Princeton. But the fearless Tigers have a last shot at knocking off the mighty Hoyas until Alonzo Mourning blocks their path and John Thompson survives to play another day. Oregon State's Ralph Miller was not as fortunate. In overtime, the Evansville Purple Aces came up with a tray. And after 674 career wins, Miller's time had come. And here you can see why it's amazing coaches survive as long as they do. South Alabama's Ronnie Arrow is headed in the right direction, along with our other winners, on the road to the Final Four. Good evening, everybody. I'm Jim Nance, along with James Brown in Studio 43 in New York City. And once again, the opening round of the NCAA tournament has yielded its share of surprises, upsets, and near misses. There are stories at every turn as we continue along the road to the Final Four here on CBS Sports.
All right, Jim, and coming up in just a few moments, we'll be going out to Tucson, Arizona for a live West Region action between Louisiana State and Texas El Paso. Now, of course, LSU features one of the most exciting players in college basketball, Chris Jackson, the remarkable freshman scoring machine who was averaging over 30 points a game. He'll be going head-to-head with the WAC Player of the Year from UTEP by the name of Tim Hardaway. Now, the winner of that contest will get a crack at Bobby Knight's Hoosiers. That's because the Hoosiers, with five starters in double figures, shook off a pesky George Mason squad by the score of 99-85. In the Southeast region, UCLA, a 10-point winner over Iowa State, 84-74. There in the East region, C.M. Newton coached his last game today. He'll be taking over the A.D. spot at Kentucky. His team a loser to Digger Phelps and Notre Dame by the score of 81-65. And in the Midwest region, Texas, with Tom Penders, the first-year coach, who, of course, last year took Rhode Island to the NCAA tournament, leading Georgia Tech 43-35. That a halftime score.
Sure has got a lot of Longhorn fans there cheering them on in Dallas tonight. Tommy Penders and Texas out in front in that one. The game of the day, it was Hoosiers all over again, folks, very nearly, as 16th-seeded Princeton took Georgetown down to the wire. I mean, it was just like Milan High School all over again. Princeton led by 8 at the half, increased it to 10, but back came Alonzo Mourning. What a game the freshman had. 21 points, 13 rebounds, 7 blocks. With the game tied at the 2-minute mark, Jerry Doyle put the Tigers back in front, driving the lane. But Alonzo hit 3 free throws to make it a 1-point Georgetown lead. The last shot came from Kit Mueller. It was blocked also. No foul, and Georgetown wins.
As I said to Pete, I'll never send another son. That's gratitude for me. I send my son to play for him, and he gives me a heart attack.
So now the East region in Providence on Sunday is set. Georgetown against Notre Dame and North Carolina State against Iowa. Two great games Sunday from Providence.
Having played against Princeton for 4 years, I know how good a ball club that team is, Jimmy. Let me tell you. Hey, kind of the state championship down in Alabama today in the Southeast region. These two teams had never met before, South Alabama and Alabama. Now, even with Michael Ansley of Alabama out with 5 fouls, it looked as if they still might pull it out when Alvin Lee nails his 3-pointer to put them up by 1 in the closing seconds. But hey, South Alabama's Jeff Hodge was not about to be outdone. He takes a 3-point shot, nails it in the closing seconds. But a last-second attempt, a desperation shot by Alabama, falls off the mark, and South Alabama wins the first ever matchup between these two schools. And hey, you can understand the joy of Ron Arrow. So the Southeast bracket looks like this. It'll be South Alabama taking on Michigan. Michigan, of course, with Steve Fisher at the helm, wins its game against Xavier. UCLA will be taking on the Tar Heels of North Carolina, the second seed in the Southeast region. The Midwest bracket looks like this. Missouri will be taking on the winner of Georgia Tech and Texas, while Colorado State, with an even tempo, will be taking on the talented Orangemen of Syracuse. And in the West bracket, Evansville, a winner in overtime, will be taking on P.J. Carlissimo's squad at Seton Hall. Indiana, Bobby Knight's squad, will be taking on the winner of UTEP and LSU. And, of course, all of those games can be seen in a triple header fashion right here on CBS.
James, there is one alarming trend right now for the SEC as LSU prepares for UTEP. 0-4 is the SEC at the moment, including 3 blowouts. Tennessee, Vanderbilt, and Florida are all beaten convincingly. LSU's the last team now in the conference with a shot at the tournament. First-round blues for the SEC. A sad note in college basketball today. Katha Quinn, the sports information director at St. John's University, succumbed to liver cancer. She was a very special person, a pioneer, and a professional. And above all, she set the standard for personal courage as she carried on without missing a beat for the past 18 months despite painful chemotherapy. Katha Quinn would have been 35 tomorrow. And we'll have the start of LSU and UTEP when the road to the Final Four continues here on CBS after this word from your local station.
On the campus of the University of Arizona in Tucson, tonight CBS Sports presents the 32nd and final first round game in the 1989 NCAA Basketball Championship. From the SEC, carrying the tattered banner of that league, the LSU Tigers take on the UTEP Miners, the champions of the Western Athletic Conference Tournament. Already today here in Tucson, Evansville outlasted Oregon State, another upset in Ralph Miller's last game. They will go on to meet Seton Hall on Sunday. The Pirates had to struggle but got by Southwest Missouri State. About a half an hour ago, the Indiana Hoosiers, seeded second in the West, got by George Mason. It became close at the end, but they really led by 30 most of the second half. Good evening, everybody. I'm Vern Lundquist, and happy St. Patrick's Day from all of us at CBS. What a terrific 2 days we've had to start this NCAA basketball championship, with upsets and near upsets being the dominant theme. Do the names Siena and Princeton strike an immediate chord? Well, that shouldn't be the case tonight. We feature two evenly matched teams in LSU and UTEP. LSU is a slight underdog only because they're the lower seed. I'm working tonight with my familiar partner, Tommy Heinsohn. Tommy, Dale Brown has this LSU Tiger team, a very young team in the tournament again. But though they are young, they have one of the best young men who's come into college basketball in recent years.
Well, there's no question about that. Chris Jackson, and I like to consider him as a child prodigy playing Mozart. He reads the music, but he makes it happen a little bit differently with his improvisations. You'll see him come up on the fast break with his head up, reading the defense, make great passes, look off. Things that you really don't expect a freshman to do. But then the other side of the coin is all out bombardment from the outside. Can he stick the threes? Great offensive player.
Don Haskins is now in his 28th year as head coach of the University of Texas at El Paso. The Bear, as he is affectionately called, is one of the most loved personalities in all of college basketball. He brings another unheralded team into the tournament again tonight, and again, Tommy, they'll feature defense.
While Don Haskins is renowned for his in-your-face man-to-man defense, boy, he challenges all over the place. But he's got a ball club that uses its quick feet and its quick hands, and now he's also added in the last few years fast break basketball. But his principles of man-to-man defense may be tested tonight by Chris Jackson.
All right, it's the seventh-seeded UTEP Miners against the 10th-seeded LSU Tigers.
CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship is sponsored by Budweiser. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. Express mail overnight service. And by Mitsubishi, bringing you the new Eclipse Sports Coupe. See it at your Mitsubishi Motors dealer.
Spring night in the lovely city of Tucson, Arizona, an area populated by some 700,000, 118 miles south of Phoenix. And we're at McHale Center, where we're going to our public address announcer, Dana Cooper, for the introduction of the starting lineups.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to McHale Center in Tucson for tonight's West Region first round game between the LSU Tigers and the Texas El Paso Miners. And now, let's meet the starting lineups. For LSU at forward, a 6'8 sophomore from DeRidder, Louisiana, number 44, Wayne Sims. For UTEP at forward, a 6'8 freshman from Mesa, Arizona, number 52, David Van Dyke. For LSU at forward, a 6'7 senior from Miami, Florida, number 33, Ricky Blanton. For UTEP at forward, a 6'2 sophomore from El Paso, Texas, number 30, Mark McCall. For LSU at center, a 6'6 freshman from Natchez, Mississippi, number 24, Vernell Singleton. And for UTEP, step at center, a 7-foot junior from Oakland, California, number 44, Greg Foster. For LSU at guard, a 6'4" sophomore from Lafayette, Louisiana, number 21, Lyle Mouton. For UTEP at guard, a 5'11" sophomore from Lexington, Kentucky, number 13, Prince Stewart. For LSU at guard, a 6'1" freshman from Gulfport, Mississippi, number 35, Chris Jackson. And for UTEP at guard, a 6-foot senior from Chicago, Illinois, number 10, Tim Hardaway. And the head coaches in his 17th season at LSU, Dale Brown. And in his 28th season as head coach of the UTEP Miners, Don Haskins.
20-11, UTEP 25-6. The tip in a moment. LSU Tigers under Dale Brown in the tournament for the sixth consecutive year. They, of course, have been in the Final Four twice in the 80s, in 1981 and again in 1986. And for the UTEP Miners, likewise, their sixth straight tournament appearance. And, of course, Don Haskins led them, Texas Western, to the 1966 championship over Kentucky at Cole Fieldhouse in College Park, Maryland. Lenny Wirtz, Sid Rotenheffer, and Mark DiStaiola are the officials, and we're underway.
UTEP has got to really got a bunch of board bangers. Four or five guys that can really rebound. That's going to be one of the big problems for LSU to contain.
They are missing their key inside, though, Antonio Davis, with knee injuries. He strained some ligaments in the semifinal game of the WAC tournament, the 6'9 junior. Tried to work out yesterday and did, but he's having problems cutting, so he is not starting tonight. We don't know whether he'll play.
He was really a great, quick rebounder, too. They will miss him.
As a result, David Van Dyke gets the starting nod. Shot clock is down to five. Hardaway from long range, short. And the rebound comes down for LSU.
LSU very successful that time with the zone. Here's Jackson.
Prince Stewart draws the task of guarding him. It's on the line. UTEP ball.
What makes Jackson so great is his dribbling ability. You're going to see a guy that really knows how to handle that ball and get defenders out of position.
Here comes Tim Hardaway, most valuable player of the Western Athletic Conference Tournament. He's a senior out of Chicago. Left side to McCall. He's the young man. He's getting his fifth start tonight. He and Van Dyke have been shuffling in and out of the starting lineup this year. First foul of the game called on Wayne Sims.
UTEP is not that bad an outside shooting ball club. They can hold their own with anybody, particularly the two guards, Hardaway and Stewart. Very good with the threes.
Brent Stewart will inbound the ball now. Just underway from McHale Center. We played a minute and 13 seconds, no score. Alley-oop. And Van Dyke, rather, comes down with it as it batted back and retains possession. They'll reload. McCall, first turnover of the game.
Looks like UTEP has the tournament jitters.
Now Chris Jackson. And again, it's Brent Stewart who will guard him. We'll check this defense. There's a steal, Stewart. Three on one. Alley-oop. McCall for two.
Well, I saw it, but I didn't believe it. Stewart with the steal on one of the cleverest dribblers I've ever seen.
Prince Stewart, the sophomore out of Lexington, Kentucky. Ricky Blanton answers with a two.
And he is top gun from that corner. He can hit the outside shot, Blanton.
Blanton, the only senior in the LSU lineup, averaging 21 points a game. Jackson, of course, averaging 30. McCall again, off balance shot. No, rebound comes down in the hands of Wayne Sims. Now Chris Jackson. That's for two.
And he got by Stewart that time, who tried again to make a steal. And that may be the worst steal that Stewart ever made.
Hardaway working on Jackson.
You know, once you make one steal, you think you can make 100. This guy isn't all he's cracked up to be. And he'll keep doing it. I'll tell you, Jackson is very, very clever.
4-2 ball game, 17-20 to go, first half. The final game, the 32nd game of the first round.
That's Stewart. Rims out, and it was a three. LSU with a two-point lead. Ricky Blanton. Sims almost lost control, and Van Dyke with his 87th block of the year. Notre Dame defeats Vanderbilt tonight in C.M. Newton's last game at Vandy. He goes to Kentucky, of course, as the athletic director. And UCLA from the Pac-10 knocks out a big 18, Iowa State. And Texas with a short four-point lead over Georgia Tech in the second half in Dallas. Johnny Melvin has come into the lineup now for UTEP. So the lineup, first substitution of the game, has Stewart, Hardaway, and Melvin, the three-guard rotation, with Van Dyke and Foster.
Well, Melvin's a freshman, but he's really played very well towards the tail end of the season.
That was Melvin, number 32. Entry pass, turn around, David Van Dyke.
Because LSU does not have depth, they don't really get aggressive at times defensively for fear of getting in foul trouble.
Jackson for three. Short. The stuff no good from Singleton. Gets the rebound. And will shoot a couple.
LSU's offense is really to put kind of four guys down on the baseline. And that leaves Jackson all kinds of room to maneuver one-on-one against his player, so his defender. So lots of problems for Stewart to defend him. And they're going to try and take the dribble away from Jackson by double teams.
This is a fellow freshman of Jackson's, Vernell Singleton, who was recruited as either an off guard or a quick forward and wound up playing center at 6'6".
Dale Brown has a knack of turning guys that are quick into centers, and he knows how to use quickness at that position, and Singleton has been very effective on the offensive glass rebound-wise.
LSU with a two-point lead, 16-15 to go first half. Stewart for three. Yes.
Right in the middle of that 2-3 zone. A little gap.
He's hitting 42% from three-point range on the year. Underneath, Sims. Rejected. Goaltending.
One of the things that Jackson does, he, with his great penetrating ability, he will spread the defense out and draw at least one defender, and he can slip the ball inside.
Looks like a 2-3 LSU zone.
Had trouble with this zone against UNLV. Even though they won the ball game, UNLV got a lot of inside hoops against them.
Greg Foster gets two from the inside. He's the one-time UCLA player who transferred and sat out last year. Jackson. Foster rebound. UTEP. Hardaway.
That is his range. He can drift. And when he pulls up, he's so quick, very difficult to get at his shot.
Three-point edge. Ricky Blanton.
Was Singleton again, coming from on top of the offense. Nobody putting a body on him.
Tim Hardaway's a senior, facing Jackson. This is Johnny Melvin. It's in and out. And the rebound, Vernell Singleton. And now a chance for LSU to regain the lead. Wayne Sims gives LSU a one-point edge.
A very short center. And power forward at 6'7". He roams around in that low post, but he can pop out and hit the 18-foot shot.
12-11, LSU leads it. This is the third time the two teams have met. There's Hardaway for three. Van Dyke tries to reach over the top.
Well, now the Texas starters coming out of the lineup and a chance to pat those kids on the back. Substitutes checking in. Tony Jones, number four. They say he's 5'7". Most people disagree with that. He's a speedster, wide receiver on the football team. He comes in. Courtney Jeans checks in. Wynn Shepherd. Also Thomas Gibson. And Blanks will be substituted. He's the only starter left on the floor, but it's because he is at the line. And for Georgia Tech, Brian Demolik has checked in for Dennis Scott, who fouled out with 16 points.
Brian Oliver scores, but the horn sounds. And the Texas Longhorns have upset the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets by a final score of 76-70. We'll be right back.
All right, so Tom Penders takes his magic down to Texas, where they win their first NCAA tournament game since 1974. All right, back in Tucson, Arizona, let's join our announcers, Vern Lundquist and Tommy Heinsohn.
Okay, JB, final 3 seconds of the first half. What was a 40-21 lead for UTEP when we left you is a 42-29 lead at halftime, as Chris Jackson did hit a couple of baskets and Ricky Blanton hit a three-pointer. We'll continue after this message and a word from your local station.
Sports Cup, the NCAA Basketball Championship, is sponsored by the Heartbeat of America, today's Chevrolet. Levi's 505.
On the floor for Chris Jackson of LSU. All right, updating a developing story concerning the Kentucky basketball program. WLEX-TV in Lexington reported today that Wildcat head coach Eddie Sutton offered to dismiss his assistant coaches, team managers, and others associated with the program if it would guarantee his return as head coach. However, Sutton has denied these allegations. Tonight, I spoke with acting athletic director Joe Birch, who would only say that he expects an announcement about the coaching situation to take place this week. Today was the final game in the 38-year collegiate coaching career for Ralph Miller, the Oregon State coach. He went into overtime against Evansville in this action earlier this afternoon. And Ralph Miller's team took it into overtime. It was the 25th overtime of the tournament in the 1980s, with Miller's team up by two. And three-point shot by Evansville. Scott Schreffler putting the Aces up by one. Gary Payton, he's a good player out there in the West Coast. In the lane, puts Oregon State back in front by one. But here's the shot that won it for Evansville. Reed Crafton from way out there, putting it up by two for Evansville. Payton came back for one last try, trying to pull it out for Oregon State. The misfire, and Ralph Miller coached his final game as Evansville was a winner in this ball game, 94-90 in overtime, and now advances on in the West to meet Syracuse. Seton Hall.
Like everything, good or bad, sooner or later, they come to an end. Well, my coaching career, for all practical purposes, is now history.
And a great career again for Ralph Miller, but let me clarify that. Evansville will advance on and take on Seton Hall Sunday in the West. And, James, that's the West situation with Indiana, again, waiting the winner of UTEP and LSU.
I know I'm going to be accused of using 2020 vision hindsight now, but I knew that Princeton team was awfully tough, a team that executes extremely well on the offensive end and has a chance. And the effect of frustrating people in Georgetown was almost frustrated out of the tournament today, holding on for a one-point victory. Now, the Hoyas more than had their hands full. Alonzo Mourning's 21 points, they would absolutely be needed. Now, Mourning was the only player that Pete Carrillo didn't have an answer for. Take a look at Georgetown on the inside. Alonzo Mourning, a little frustrated, throws an elbow there at the big fella Mueller. Now, in the closing seconds, Alonzo Mourning comes up with the biggest block of the game, one of seven, and Bobby Knight talks about the potential upset.
If you've watched Pete Carrillo's teams play over the years, he's going to find a way to get the absolute maximum out of his team, and I think he obviously did that tonight. And he's got a team that handles the ball well, works at handling the ball, and they would cause problems because Georgetown is overplaying a lot, and I can just kind of close my eyes and watch Princeton's kids getting some back cut layups and getting some chances to go to the basket. And sometimes when you get into that kind of a situation with Georgetown, it's just hard to get out of.
And Princeton executes the backdoor offense as well as anyone in the country. That was not a halftime score. That was a final, Georgetown by one over Princeton. Now, Georgetown will move on to meet Notre Dame. That's because Digger Phelps' team came away a victor over Vanderbilt and C.M. Newton, 81-65. Now, C.M. Newton was hoping to prolong his coaching career just a little longer, The Damian Sweet of Notre Dame, nice-looking alley-oop for the slam and an 11-point lead. Even without the coronation, Digger Phelps had the luck of the Irish, and a talented freshman named LaFonso Ellis with the reverse layup and the victory. They now move on to second-round action and will meet in the East, Georgetown. What a powerful matchup there, Georgetown and Notre Dame. And a nice backcourt combination matchup will be between NC State, with, of course, Rodney Monroe and Chris Corciana, against Iowa with Roy Marble and B.J. Armstrong. And we'll have more Road to the Final Four halftime report for you right after these commercial messages.
From Tucson to Dallas, nobody ever said it was easy to travel on the road to the Final Four. Florida's cheerleaders had to do it without their pep band, so they asked Georgia Tech's band if they wouldn't mind sitting in. Show us your music, they said, in the spirit of cooperation, and by game time, they were ready to don their new Florida t-shirts and come to the Gators' aid. Unfortunately for Florida fans, their team itself played woefully out of sync today. And that score for the Gators, 68-46 on the short end of the score against the regular season champions out of the Western Athletic Conference, Colorado State the winner. Impressive showing there by Boyd Grant's team. And I don't think there's any question about it. This is a team to look out for now after Colorado State's performance today against Florida. Now, the Rams will advance on and play Syracuse on Sunday. Now, in Dallas, we saw it moments ago, Texas a winner over Georgia Tech. Texas led by the Southwest Conference Player of the Year, Travis Mays, 23 points, and now the Longhorns are set to play Missouri on Sunday, which is interesting because Tommy Penders, the Texas coach, we all know it now. He was at Rhode Island last year, and last year he was the guy that knocked Missouri out of the tournament. Rhode Island upsetting Missouri. He meets him for the second straight year in the tournament. Can he do it again? And again, it's Colorado State against Syracuse, and this Colorado State team of Boyd Grant, I'm very impressed by that bunch, James, today after that performance against Florida.
Indeed, and no need for Tom Pennis to worry about a tanning machine down in Dallas. He's got sun all year long, no doubt about that. Hey, great game played in the Southeast region down in Atlanta. Steve Fisher, of course, in a tough position as the interim coach, but he led the Michigan Wolverines to a five-point victory over Xavier. Bill Frieder, the former coach, had to buy a ticket for this one, and what he saw was Xavier's squad battle the Wolverines tooth and nail and take a four-point second-half lead on that fast break there. But hey, Terry Mills has been a hot and cold player. He was Mr. Aggressive today as he slammed Michigan back on top with two of his 18. And Mills got involved with helping others to score as well, specifically teammate Glenn Rice with two of his 23 points as interim coach Steve Fisher comes away with his first victory by five over Xavier. So the Southeast bracket looks like this. South Alabama, the surprise winner over Alabama, will now meet Michigan. And Iowa State, with a strong backcourt, will take on North Carolina.
James, I don't mean to harp on it, but the SEC just mailing it in this tournament. We've mentioned that four teams have played before tonight. All four have lost, including Florida, Vanderbilt, and Tennessee, losing in blowout games, and Alabama blowing a big lead and eventually losing to South Alabama. Now LSU's the last team out of that conference, and here they are trailing by 13 at the intermission. Let's remind you that tomorrow triple-header action on CBS gets started at noon Eastern. Most of the country will see West Virginia against Duke. Again, that's at 12 noon Eastern. Then at 2, some of you will see Ball State against Illinois. Others will watch Louisiana Tech against Oklahoma. Will the Sooners bounce back and play like they were during the middle of the season? And we'll also have some folks seeing Siena against Minnesota in East region action. And then the third game of the triple header, DePaul against UNLV. Others will watch Arkansas and Louisville. I really like that matchup tomorrow. And Middle Tennessee State against Virginia. Now, for you folks on the West Coast and in Arizona and South Carolina, you'll also be getting the game between Clemson and Arizona. That's at 4 o'clock Pacific time. 7 o'clock for you folks in South Carolina as the Clemson Tigers take on the top seed out in the West, the Arizona Wildcats. JB, what about the second half here for LSU?
I tell you right now, I think in the first half, LSU was standing around a little too much, watching Chris Jackson, waiting for him to do the exciting thing. And in the process, UTEP just blew right by him. They were excited about the matchup against Chris Jackson.
All right, but again, that lead at one time was 19. It's been trimmed to 13. We'll get you back to Vern Lundquist and Tommy Heinz.
And they flipped the ball to him on the inside. Now, he could outleap anybody that LSU had on the inside, and he really did what you're supposed to do. Go over the top of a smaller player.
Yeah!
second. He and Jackson both with 31 points tonight. Here's Chris Jackson as we're near the 115 mark. Dipped it in, Vernell Singleton. And timeout is called by LSU. 83-69, we have 70 seconds left. Big day here in Tucson in the West Region. Evansville with an overtime win today.
Boy, was that a basketball game, and a very, very confident and spunky little guy, Reed Hefton, hit that shot. Hefner really did a great job.
And in Boise, Arizona and Clemson advance, DePaul and UNLV. And you'll see them tomorrow from Boise. Arizona, of course, the number one seed in the West. This is their home court. The last team to beat them here, as a matter of fact, was UTEP in the 87 tournament. And a collision down along the baseline. Vernell Singleton, the freshman. For LSU.
You can look at Hardaway, spots his man, who really kind of went way past the basket. Had a lean back, and that allowed Singleton to get back into the play. He had his man beaten by about 20 feet, but he didn't know where he was when he ended up with the ball. He should have stopped a little bit because the pass was right on the money. Those are little things that players coming from another continent have to learn. And they are very pleased with him. They say he's only played 3 years of basketball, and he's got great foot movement and great hand movement. And you saw him block some shots this evening, or at least create some problems defensively. So he's going to be an effective player. They got big hopes for him.
Here's Jackson. 1 minute to go. Foul called on Prince Stewart. The UTEP bench. They will play another game Sunday afternoon here against Indiana. I rather imagine Bobby Knight would just as soon play Don Haskins as that man, Dale Brown. They have a well-documented dislike for each other.
I think Bobby and Haskins are good buddies.
Yes, they are.
As a matter of fact.
As opposed to Brown and Knight.
Yep.
Greg Foster is out. And Knight back in. Three-point shot. Lyle Mouton. 55 seconds remaining in this ball game. It's 83-72 right now. We're going to go back to our New York studios. Here is Jim Nance.
Well, Vern, thank you. And a chance for us to, again, set the lineup that now really is just hours away as we get set for second round action. Tripleheader Saturday coming your way, 12 noon Eastern. West Virginia against Duke to most of the nation. Then at 2 Eastern, some of you will see Ball State against Illinois. Others will watch Louisiana Tech against Oklahoma. Some will see Siena against Minnesota. At 4:30 Eastern time, DePaul, UNLV headlines the action there. Arkansas and Louisville also play. Middle Tennessee State collides with Virginia. That's 4:30 Eastern. For those of you on the West Coast and in Arizona and South Carolina, you also get the game between Clemson and Arizona starting at 4 o'clock Pacific time. Let's go back for the finale now in Tucson. Back to Vern.
All right, Jim, 55 seconds to go. Chris Jackson, who missed two of his, or hit only two of his first 11 shots, has connected on 13 of his last 20. So he winds up right about his season average. He's got 31 points for the night. And in the process, becomes the all-time leading scorer for freshmen in NCAA history. He also, of course, is the first freshman since Wayman Tisdale of Oklahoma to be named as an All-American first-teamer. He's named three first teams so far.
Well, I would say that he has got a great, bright future. Red Auerbach thinks that if he came out this year, he would be the first guy picked in the draft, at least by the Boston Celtics. If they were to have the first pick in the draft, that's how highly he thinks of him. But Jackson is really going to even continue to grow. He's a very, very intelligent player and understanding what the possibilities are. And he uses this great athletic ability he has to outquick somebody, but it's taken hours and hours and hours to get that dribbling to the point where he uses it so effectively.
11-point UTEP lead. Prince Stewart, who's had a dandy night for the most part, gets rid of it. And Tim Hardaway has the ball. Stewart. Shot clock at 30, game clock at 37. All the way in Jackson. And the foul is on Chris Jackson. UTEP, the second of the Western Athletic Conference teams to advance. And it's been fun for both of us to sit back the last 2 days and watch the Siennas and the South Alabamas and the Texases, hasn't it?
You know, that makes all those programs feel that they've got some place to go in the next several years. You know, for a school like Siena to get past the first round, that's awfully important for their whole program for the next 5 years.
Not to say for their bank account.
Well, forget that. I really, talking about the coaching and the kids in the school, and Holy Cross won it way back in the 40s, and the whole town of Worcester turned out, something that never happened before.
Jackson's final shot doesn't fall. Askins and Brown beat at midcourt. Jackson hits for 33, but Tim Hardaway leads UTEP with 31, and the Miners knock off LSU by 11. Let's go back to Jim Nance in New York.
Vern, thank you. So now Indiana and UTEP are set to play on Sunday, and really the Bear, Don Haskins and Bobby Knight are big friends. In fact, they have met four times in the 80s, with Indiana winning on three of those occasions. In fact, they already met once this year in Bloomington, and Indiana won that game 81-63 over the Miners, but now they'll meet in the tournament second round. And James, before this game tonight, you were talking about Hardaway. You said this guy's a big-time player. You hit that right on the money.
Quickness, the NBA scouts love him, and I tell you, it's going to be a lot closer game this time between UTEP and Indiana. And talking about the game MVPs, well, indeed, it was a great individual matchup between Chris Jackson and Tim Hardaway. Chris Jackson, the MVP for LSU with a game-high 33 points. Tim Hardaway with 31 points, but of course, Tim Hardaway had a better supporting cast. And we'll be back with more post-game interviews out in Tucson, Arizona.
This is College Basketball Preview with your host, John Fricke.
Good morning and welcome to CNN's College Basketball Preview. I am John Fricke. What a tournament it's been. Today we'll update you on all the games thus far, plus two special interviews for you live with UCLA head coach Jim Herrick. And today we're joined by our old friend Danny Sheridan with his picks for the rest of the way. But what a weird tournament, and we've only played round number one. In a few minutes, we'll hear from Danny as he explains why a team he rated as 1 billion to 1 to win it all took the tournament favorite to the wall last night. An Ivy League scare of major magnitude for a Big East power. Georgetown had its hands full and then some with Princeton. And boy, the Tigers simply did a number, didn't they? It was an incredible game in the East. John Thompson's Hoyas frustrated all evening long. Second half, the game was tied at 43 after Princeton led by 8 at the break and great backdoor cuts. This time, Kit Mueller to George Leftwich, and Princeton led again by 2. Just over 2 minutes to go, the Tigers still up when Mark Tillman penetrates, hits the running jumper. Georgetown could not get inside despite its overwhelming height advantage, but Alonzo Mourning finally gave Georgetown a 1-point lead with time running down. Bob Scrabbe's shot is blocked by Mourning. Could Princeton get the ball back for a last chance? And the answer was yes, with a second to go. One more chance, and Kit Mueller tried to get the ball and go up with it, but the shot was tipped away, and Princeton took a heartbreaking loss, and oh, what a toughie it was after the Hoyas pulled out a real heart stopper last night. It could be a wild, wild weekend ahead of us. Meanwhile, Notre Dame and Vanderbilt had the luck of the Irish on St. Patrick's Day at that, in green uniforms for Notre Dame. First half, Elmer Bennett, alley-oop time to Damian Sweet, and Notre Dame led by 11. Meanwhile, second half, Joe Frederick got the hot hand, parking out from three-point territory, and number three hit threes. The Irish pulling away at this point. Meanwhile, when Frederick wasn't hitting the threes, he was getting a great post up inside from Alfonso Ellis with the power move. Vanderbilt was never in it. Yet another SEC team that struggled all night as Notre Dame won by 16. Meanwhile, North Carolina State pounded South Carolina yesterday, 81-66. The Wolfpack, shaking off the effects of that stunning ACC tournament loss to Maryland, blew the Gamecocks out and now face Iowa behind B.J. Armstrong, who tied a career high with 35 points. The Hawkeyes won despite the absence of starter Ray Thompson, who was suspended from the game for academic reasons. And here they are, the second-round survivors in the East. It'll be Georgetown against Notre Dame, North Carolina State, and Iowa. Minnesota playing the Siena Saints, everybody's upset Cinderella favorite at the moment, and West Virginia against Duke in what could be a very, very interesting second-round game. Well, who would have thought powerhouse Michigan would have been racked by the controversy that has surrounded the Wolverines this week? Head coach Bill Frieder resigned to take over at Arizona State. Michigan athletic director Bo Schembechler felt Frieder wouldn't be 100% pro-Wolverines because of the new job. He then, in a stunning move, let Frieder go right before the Wolverines began tournament play.
I do regret the timing. And, you know, all I can say is I'm going to probably, there'll be some negatives about me at that end. But I think what's negative at that end is going to be positive at this end.
I don't want somebody from Arizona State coaching a Michigan team. And I want that understood. A Michigan man is going to coach Michigan. This is Michigan, son. We can afford to do anything we want to do.
Well, that new Michigan man is Steve Fisher. He's the interim coach. First half, Xavier of Ohio, the Musketeers in blue. Michael Davenport lost the ball, though, in heavy traffic. Michigan's Ramil Robinson picked it up. Fast break jam time as the Wolverines forged a 31-all tie. Second half, though, Stan Kimbrough tries the layup, misses. Davenport there, though, for the follow. And, hey, the Musketeers lead by three. And Xavier, though, went into the press. Michigan then beat it with its superior talent and speed. It didn't look pretty, folks, but Glenn Rice got loose with a jam underneath, and Michigan pulled it out by 11 as they took out Xavier, rather by 5, and took out Xavier to move to the next round. Michigan's now 25-7. Meanwhile, I'll tell you who he won't have to play is Alabama and Wimp Sanderson, because the Jaguars of South Alabama looking for respect. Wimp Sanderson said, hey, we won't play these guys in the regular season because we don't have to, but Alabama got a career high out of Gary Waiters, 25 points to go up by 5 late, but South Alabama in the dark uniform simply would not die. Down 16 at the break, they got every roll, it seemed like, in the second half, played great defense. Bama came right back, though. Alvin Lee with a 3-point bomb had to put Bama up with just about a minute to go, but it was the Jaguars' Jeff Hodge from downtown, almost pro three-pointer for the game-winning hoop, as South Alabama held on as Alabama missed at the buzzer to give South Alabama a stunning win over its rivals in state, or its rivals now. Both teams 23-8, but the Tide season's now over. Meanwhile, UCLA got a big night from let's talk about Pooh Richardson first. In white, UCLA, Richardson threw up the brick. Victor Alexander had the rebound for Iowa State to Adrian Moore, and UCLA's lead was only one. Iowa State led 60-59 when UCLA went on a run. Moore off the front of the rim. Trevor Wilson to Pooh Richardson, who had a great game, 19 points, 14 assists. And UCLA and Jim Herrick, who we'll speak with in just a minute, off and running and looking awfully good, trying to kick the ball to Iowa State as Richardson later found Charles Rochelin, and UCLA blew out Iowa State by 10. And now the Ucklins go on to face North Carolina, which may be a little bit tough because Carolina won the ACC tournament on this very floor just a week ago. They were down by 10 points to Southern University 7 minutes into the game, but superior height and talent of North Carolina prevailed in that one. So the final eight in the Southeast Regional, Oklahoma against Louisiana Tech could be a very interesting game, as the way the Sooners are playing at the moment. Virginia against Middle Tennessee State, South Alabama, the upset winners against Michigan, and in a game everybody will keep their eye on, UCLA and North Carolina could set the tempo for this region, maybe for the tournament in round number two. Well, coming up, we'll swing around the other regions and check in on Ralph Miller, his final NCAA tournament stand as the Beavers look to topple Evansville. That and much more for you in just a minute on CNN's College Basketball Preview. Miller has never once reached the Final Four. Would this be a fitting and sweet way to end it all if his Beavers could get on a tournament run towards Seattle? But they had to face Evansville, and the Purple Aces are a little bit tough. And there's Ralph taking in the action. Scott Hafner, remember his name? He was the guy who had 65 points in a game earlier this season, and Evansville led by a point late. This is all in overtime. The Beavers come back. Gary Payton, the pull-up Jay in the lane, and whoa, Oregon State has a one-point lead, but time running or winding down. Reed Crafton, Evansville in those unique uniforms, the shirts and not the normal basketball uniforms. Recrafted from downtown with 11 points to go, wins it as Evansville knocks Ralph Miller out of the tournament by 4 points. Meanwhile, Indiana cruises, certainly no problem for the White Clyde Hoosiers. Jay Edwards, great pass, no-look pass to Todd Jadlow. and outmanned George Mason from the Colonial Conference. You say, hey, this is a rout. Remember, last year, Indiana lost to a team from the Colonial Conference, Richmond, but this year the Hoosiers blew it open early. Here it's Joe Hillman on the lay-in. Made it look awfully easy. Moments later, Edwards, top of the key as he posts up for a three. Well, he was wide open, actually, as Indiana, the score really not indicative of how much of a rout it was, 99-85 over George Mason. Meanwhile, Texas El Paso and Don Haskins, remember, this coach won a national title. Granted, it was 23 years ago. UTEP held off LSU. Tim Hardaway had 31. The Miners are 26-6 and will play Indiana next. Meanwhile, John Morton had 26 as Seton Hall ran its record to 27-6, holding off Southwest Missouri State. So in the West, the final eight look like this. It is Arizona and Clemson in what could be a very interesting matchup. Another interesting one, DePaul and UNLV, Evansville and Seton Hall. And for that matter, every matchup here in the West is going to evoke some sort of emotion. UTEP and Indiana could be a real dandy. Meanwhile, Missouri is one of the nation's hottest and most talented teams. Of course, they went through a late-season slump after head coach Norm Stewart fell ill. Rich Daly took his spot on the bench, came under fire for letting the team slip, and then led it to the Big 8 tournament title. The Tigers opened against a team from its neck of the woods, the Missouri Valley champions from Omaha, Creighton University. The Blue Jays put on a pretty good show against Rich Daly and his Missouri Tigers. First half, Creighton stayed close. Matter of fact, Chad Gallagher underneath on the alley-oop had 16 in the first half, and the Blue Jays led at the break by two. Missouri, though, blew it open in the second half, a 16-2 run. A lot of turnovers. Sloppy ball by Tony Baroni's club. Byron Irvin had 25 on the night, gets the roll here as Missouri blew it open and coasted. Irvin had seven of his 25 during that run, and again, Creighton couldn't get inside against the trees. Missouri's got some big boys in there. Lee Coward to Anthony Peeler. Great pass to Irvin for the layup. Missouri wins by 16, 85-69. No slight against Creighton. Missouri's on a roll. Georgia Tech took it on the chin again. This time in Dallas, Texas, with all its fans watching. Travis Mays got him out early. The layup in Texas with that run-and-gun offense of Tom Penders and Bobby Kremen saying, no way we're going to be able to stop him tonight. Georgia Tech had the horses but couldn't stop inside as Tom Hammonds had another big night, but it wasn't going to be enough. Georgia Tech trailed from the get-go. Texas lit it up, threw up those shots. They have about a five-second shot clock under Penders. Again, Mays along the baseline as Texas took him out 76-70. Meanwhile, Colorado State added to the woes of the SEC. The SEC's had five teams to this tournament, went 0-5, and not one of them was close. As Florida got hammered, the Rams' first trip to the postseason in 20 years, Florida's lowest total of the year in their season.